good nowadays. He's gotten really far into the DreamHack, and I mean, actually, that's back-to-back finals from him and the HTC. So he's really starting to pick up the results, and I think he's looking to come out strong here, not just for himself and on behalf of Team Complexity, but for Team Value Town with him, Kibler, and Trump. People are pegging him, as well as the rest of the team, as one of their favorite tournament or favorite teams in the tournament, not to necessarily win, but just in terms of, you know, the personal following, because they have a lot of players that they like and enjoy watching.
That's right. Valuetown does have a pretty nice roster. Kibler hasn't had quite the tournament success of Trump and Dog, but so far in the Archon League, he's undefeated. So, hey, no complaints there. The team is looking as strong as ever.
And I'm actually realizing that the captains for these teams have won a tournament each, but I don't think I've really seen Kibler, Dog, Oskaka, and Chalky take down tournaments. They always gotten like second place or like pretty far in. I guess Kibler won Challenge Stone, but in terms of like the constructed tournaments where you really go for that glory and all the prize money, I think these guys are really looking for some good results here coming up soon.
Yeah, I feel like Chalky had to have won something like some time ago. He's
Used to win a
kind
lot
of
of
like
Concord
Dog.
tournaments.
He's just placed like really well a lot of the time. But yeah, I don't know. There's been so many over the course of the last year in Hearthstone. So here we have it. We have Dog versus Kaka. Dog on Priest again. I'm betting it's the same deck I saw him play a few days ago, which is the anti-aggro Deathlord Priest, which seems like it might be pretty poorly against Rogue because a lot of the strength of the deck relies in buffing minions, and that is not so great when you're facing sap.
Yeah, for sure. I think I like to hear RDU's talk about this a little bit because I know he's a big Rogue specialist, and he's actually very fair. RDU, what do you think about Rogue versus Priest nowadays? Has it gotten any better at all for the Priest?
I think it has because the priest has the power to just play threats. When I started playing priest like some months ago, I realized that you can actually win versus rogue if you manage to pressure, and if the rogue doesn't have a way to deal with your pressure, you just win the game. Also, Harrison helps a lot.
Oh, certainly. Because part of the reason of what makes it really difficult is that Rogue can outvalue Priest very easily, and Priest doesn't have a lot of inherent card draw in the normal deck, right? If you don't have the Norshire Cleric, how are you normally drawing cards? So if Rogue outvalues you and gets even a big Blade Flurry, you run out of threats. And like RDU said, if you can't keep up that pressure, what do you end up doing? But in this scenario, Harrison Jones really helps that. Thought Steal gets an okay.
Oh
An
no,
okay pick.
that's like a really good thought steal, I feel.
You think
There's
so?
yeah, there's cards that just suck. Like you can't use so many of the cards. You can't use Blade Flurry, you can't use Deadly Poison, you can hardly use the
This
Tinker
place is
Oil.
toast.
Sprint is often like too big of a tempo loss to play. There's just so many cards in the Rogue deck that just failed to get any value with the Thought Steal. And that's another problem. Like you mentioned, it's hard to keep up card draw, to keep up everything. And it's you know impacted even more when Priest often relies on Thought Steal to get that edge against other classes.
Consider.
Fair enough. It's just that the Pilot Shredder is good for the continual pressure. And actually, I really like Sap too, now I think about it, because if you can continue to apply that pressure, it might not matter what they're putting out onto the board to try and stall you.
Sapping a Shredder is like a huge tempo. So if the rogue somehow draws into Shredder and the priest manages to sap that and play something himself, he might be favored to win this versus Soskaka.
All right, well there's quite a bit to think about here. He has a very high value hand, but it's a lot of the same. Like Lotham doesn't really accomplish anything here. You got two Azure Drakes, so you're kind of like thinking about putting one out this turn because it's hard to play two at any other time.
You could also backstep Tinker.
Actually, I
Is
like the
this a
backstep Tinker, yeah.
Is this a hand that you can afford to go aggressive? I guess you can. You already have a flurry, and you have ways to refill the hand too with sprint and two Azure Drakes.
I wonder if Lotep was better than the Azir Drake, because if you go for backstab and trade with SI, you could play Lotep to stop him from playing any spells and guarantee the 5 damage and then follow up with Azir Drake. But at the same time, if you play Azir Drake, you can follow up with Lotep and be in the same spot.
Lotha may have turned out a little bit better as he's facing a 4-5 shredder here.
Lotha was better because on turn 6, usually Priest has a play, but on turn 5, they usually do spells. That's what I was thinking. But Toskaka is a rogue specialist. He likes to play rogue a lot. And from what we heard from Blizzard, he's the player with the biggest win rate.
So he knows, if it was for one season, I think. It's not like he's the best overall win rate. I'm sure there's, you know, some people who have absurd win rate but don't play very much. But I think Oskaka had the single highest win rate in any individual season on ladder, which is like really impressive because I think it was like almost 70% or something. So either way, he's played a lot of games with Rogue, like you mentioned. So I usually trust his judgment because he's definitely like thinking about a lot of the possibilities, kind of like life coach in a way. He doesn't just make a play because he felt like it was good. He thought through a lot of the options.
What do you think of Light Bomb here? Just deal with both Drakes.
Looks pretty good.
Yeah, how else do you deal with these Drakes? I guess the only other alternative is to either load up the board or to sap one and trade the other.
Yeah, but if you sap, you don't have much of a play besides Deathlord.
Right.
That doesn't feel very good.
Cable is kind of useless. You can only use it on Talnos or on something he gets from Shredder. Sivanas is also pretty bad in this matchup. Harrison, on the other hand, is nice.
Well, I believe this deck does run the Shrinkmeister. So with the Shrinkmeister, you get a lot more options from those cards. I have no
time for games. Yeah, you're right. You can still Drakes even. Sylvanas. That's actually a really good play because if he wants to kill the Sylvanas using the Drake and the Dagger, he cannot kill the Shredder. But this way he can kill it with the Fan of Knives, which is a card that rogues usually run to off.
Yeah, but if you do the Fan of Knives, do you have much flexibility?
Yeah, you can play a free drop. Or you can prep Fan of Knives.
Well, we have to consider the options from the Shredder then, right? If we do the Fan of Knives first.
Oh yeah, I guess you could fan first to see.
Yeah, but what if it's like a Noyatron? Can we deal with like all the options?
You can, but you just have to part ways with another card like Blade Flurry. That's really annoying.
You probably have to attack first because the chance of him getting a Taunt is bigger than the chance of him getting a Doomsayer. And him getting a Doomsayer is like the only bad scenario.
Oh my goodness.
He's just going for face. He calculated a possible turn to Lethal. Two turn Lethal, sorry.
Okay. If he adds another oil next turn, that's 9 damage plus the... Well, that's it. The Azdrake's not going to survive.
That's a pretty good Harrison.
I did hear that face is the place, so...
Inspired. All right, he was finally rewarded for Pilot Shredder being in the middle, by the way.
Yeah.
Already, when you play, you
one
have
extra damage.
I don't think it really mattered because it would buff Harrison no matter what. And if Sivana survives next turn, you still win. In this situation, it didn't matter that much. But yeah, he got rewarded.
So many options. Always play that Pilot Shredder in the middle. You get the doggy and the Flame Tongue Totem.
Yeah, it's a good technical play for sure.
You also get a smaller creature just in case Betrayal ever gets teched in, you know?
That's right. You're absolutely correct.
I'm not sure if I ever saw Betrayal being played on Constructed.
It was back in the early. Yeah.
It's not that bad in Arena either. So if you play other game modes, you might see it once in a while, but I can understand it. I don't really feel like Betrayal is very common at all in any race.
This should be game over. You just low tap Devlord and go full phase, right?
Yeah, there's no way to actually deal with this board. Low tap draw here was really big, and there's just no way to take care of the board, and his big weapon was taken care of. So sometimes in your low tap, Rogue can still Blade Flurry for, you know, 7 mana and take care of the board, but in this case, Oskaka has nothing, and the Priest is destroying the Rogue right now.
Well, Rogue drawing double oil, double sprint, no preparation, sap only now. Kind of poor draws from Oskaka's side. But this is what happens when you play Rogue. This is the kind of things that can happen.
Yeah, it's true. One of the criticisms against bringing Rogue is that you often beat yourself because the way the draws end up panning out, and you just don't have enough resources, or you just have awkward draws all throughout the game. So I guess that was a really good case study of the rogue not having what they need, and the priest was able to pressure with a really good curve.
That's kind of a theme for most decks that are somewhat combo-oriented. Rogue isn't exactly like a one combo type of deck. It's just a lot of cards have to synergize a lot of other cards. And those type of decks just struggle with that in general. So, yeah, absolutely. But look at that. Priest continues undefeated. Look at that. Oh, man.
Undefeated for the week, right? Is that what we're going
for
with?
Dog, yeah.
Oh, for dog.
For the week.
Okay.
For the week, too. Sure.
No, it's, I mean, it's out of the way. It's interesting that some of these guys that are bringing the different unique classes to are throwing out their unusual classes first. If you can recall last week, Valuetown threw out the Mech Shaman first to just start things off, and other people were throwing Paladin to begin things, even though you know you have Warrior and Warlock and Hunter, all classes that are like really strong overall against the field.
I think it was RDU that threw out Paladin first for his team. What was that like? Is there some kind of strategy that you'd like to talk to us about?
Personally, I don't think pick order matters in Conquest. It's like statistical, not worth to just go with the weakest class or anything other strategy you can think of. I think you just like roll a die or pick yourself randomly. That's like the best way to go. Because you become unpredictable. If you think you're better than your opponent, you don't want to give him the edge of out mind gaming you in the picking side. Just, if you pick randomly, you cannot get mind gamed. And if you think you are better skill-wise, why not just pick randomly all the time? Because in Conquest, it doesn't matter, since you have to win with every deck.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, certainly good to see the Priest pick up a win. And we also we touched a little bit on how these players have to bring a few suboptimal classes. So Trump has Paladin, and the team has, I guess, more than one of these classes that we would maybe consider suboptimal because they failed to bring Warlock. Now, what do you think about the Paladin class? We saw you play like the aggressive all-in Divine Favor Paladin. Is there any other type of Paladin that you can play right now?
You can play Midranger Control, but I don't think it's as good as Aggro Paladin. Aggro Paladin just has the option to beat everything. You can get a really good, insane Divine Shield start with a lot of buffs to follow up. Unfortunately, I only got that kind of hand in the last game. I wish I had something close to that in the first game versus Firebad, as Chucky did. I know Chucky also used the Aggro Paladin. I think it's the best type of Paladin you can play, and a really fine-tuned list can be really good. We saw last month that Aggro Paladin reached number one legend on both servers a couple times. Actually, it even did that in China, so on all the servers. I think Aggro Paladin is something insane. And we might see Chucky bringing Aggro Paladin again versus Trump's possibly mid-range Paladin, and that Trump doesn't like Aggro that much.
Well, I started talking about Paladin. I didn't realize we're about to see a Paladin versus Paladin game.
Oh, boy.
It seems like if both players are playing the aggressive Paladin that This is the type of game that ends up winding down immediately as neither player's Divine Favor is going to get much value.
Yeah, although I think Trump would be playing more the mid-range, or at least the slower Paladin. I don't know if you consider it mid-range or control, because I've seen it play a lot on stream. And Trump seems to be more of a man of science when it comes to Hearthstone. Like, he plays a lot of the deck. I'd be very surprised if Trump just whipped out a deck that he hasn't shown many people.
I feel that in this matchup, Aggro Paladin is heavily favored.
Yeah. In the Paladin mirrors in general that I've experienced, the faster deck kind of wins by a lot. And this Aggro Paladin that Chucky will probably be playing is a lot faster than the typical mid-range Paladin.
Zombichao is going to be pretty good.
Yeah.
So Chucky needs a really good start to be able to overcome that. At the same time, if Trump gets his taunts out, he will stand a chance. Usually, the only taunts that the midrange Paladin have is like a Belcher and maybe an Argus, and Belcher usually gets silenced. So if you get a really good quality Argus, you can stop the Aggro Paladin.
Mm-hmm. It's true, and then also, Paladin midrange Paladin is capable of curving out just as well as some of the aggressive ones with you know, mini bots muster for battle, and you have a big board too, fighting back immediately. And that's part of what Paladin is really good at, seizing that tempo if it curves out well. Although we don't really know. Okay, I was about to say we don't really know Chalky's hand at the moment. That's kind of awkward.
What do you think is the best way to play this? You could go for the abusive and then coin master, and you deal with the zombie chow. But then if your opponent has a 2-drop, it becomes kind of bad. So now Chalky probably calculates the chance of Trump having a 2-drop to follow the zombie chow.
I think just playing the shield and mini bot counters a lot of 2-drops. So I kind of like the shield and mini bot.
Yeah, mini bot allows you to answer pretty much whatever comes out, but then your follow up, like Artie said, is a lot weaker too, because then you only have knife juggle the following turn and abusive plus a 1-drop. So I like that this keeps more options available, because the muster for battle can come out and control the board, or he can even take it based off his next draw and play it according to his curve.
If Trump would draw Master for Battle, he would put himself in like an almost unlosable spot unless Chalky gets Consecration. But at this point, Chalky, I don't think he can play around Master for Battle. I think he just YOLOs Minibot and hopes for the best.
Mm-hmm.
You might want to keep the coin to go turn 4 Knife Juggler coin Master for Battle as Chalky, but he might not be able to be that defensive. He might have to coin Master.
Yeah, you have to coin Master here.
So now he decides to not play around Master, which is like a really good play by Chalky. You need to know when to go aggressive and not to care about your opponent's cards. Put this apple on your head. Double knife juggler is kind of threatening. I think you have to hit the face. Trading there is like pretty bad because your opponent has to trade for you anyways.
Yeah, there's really nothing that you can be surprised based off of a 3 mana, right? He already used Abusive Sergeant as well. So he can't take out both Knife Jugglers, at least at the moment, from what you've seen.
Yeah, it's just that this deck has like a lot of buffs. Like even Abusive, that kind of stuff. It's just if you can't kill both the guys, then you might as well not kill either of them. I think that's most of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Let me think. What do you think of playing Minibot, trading one dude and the face into one juggler, ignoring the other juggler, and then hoping that the Minibot keeps the Divine Shield next turn, so that you either trade or just Blessing of Kings?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Blessing of Kings has just gotten so much better with Divine Shield, so I definitely like playing Minibot first, so that way you keep your options open. Oh,
wow, look at face that. Juggle. That is a really, really bad juggle.
Yeah. It's unfortunate because even if he hit like the 1-1, at least he'd be able to keep his knife juggler reasonable health. But this can be pretty brutal.
Actually, this can be pretty brutal for Chalky here because it seems like the knife juggler play is better than the play with Kings. And because of that, he's going to open himself to concentrate a little bit though. But he gets the juggle that Trump was looking for.
Yeah.
And instead, he's a bit resilient to Consecrate. Doesn't run up against the Belcher.
Chalky plays around Consecration really well, but by not going double juggler. That's really smart.
Okay. Well, here I think it's pretty easy King's play. When do you want to drop that Argent Squire to go for the juggle? Do you want to do it on the slime?
Sure, why not? If it misses, you can still trade the dude. Let's see, 50-50. You want to get rid of the Squire as soon as possible so that you get Divine Favor value.
Mm-hmm.
And you do not really care about the 1-1 since you don't run Quartermaster, you just want the maximum damage output. And Trump is in a pretty grim spot right now.
Yeah, one of the issues that the mid-range Paladin has is that it's very hard to actually play something relevant while answering one of your opponent's threats. It's kind of why the deck is labeled for slow.
So that's one of the reasons why I don't know why would you play it over Warlock. Like, a Handlock or a Zoo is so much better versus most of the decks out there. Mm-hmm. While, as you said, mid-range Pali is pretty slow.
So he gets like a really good peacekeeper, but it doesn't actually matter because he continues to lose.
Yeah. If he gets an owl, it will become a 2-2, right? If he tries to silence his own mini bot.
Right.
But that's not an option.
An owl would be okay because you'd get a pretty decent consecrate.
Mm. Yeah, but even if he gets the consecration off, I think the board's built up enough that if he can't clear it, just more pressure will be coming every single turn.
And this is a kind of another aspect that people don't really keep in mind, because usually a lot of these games have to do with like combos and are very one-sided. But in these marginal situations, if you're behind against like a high number of creatures and your board clear is not effective, you often have to make suboptimal plays that just result in you playing more things. So Sylvanas seemed like a much better play there, but Sylvanas will trade into the small creature board of Chalky over too many turns for it to be relevant.
Mm-hmm. Sure, sure.
This How much is damage is divine...
this, by the way? Oh, is this Divine Favor? Because I just think we can calculate damage as well.
You want to play the Divine Favor now, because you want to play 2 silver next turn and you will not have mana to Divine Favor. And there's a big chance you draw a 1-drop, because this deck runs a lot of 1-drops. I know that also Chalky runs Deckhand and Worgen in his deck. And now he can go really aggressive. He gets double juggler hits. That's a really good turn. But the question is, do you trade or do you just go for face?
Face is the place, man.
You let your opponent have better trades himself if you go for face. But,
Yeah, well, I think that's unfortunately it, right? Because Trump has to use Consecration here, but he doesn't have enough to use Healbot or Taunt anything.
Yeah. Exactly the problem the deck runs into here.
Just one mana short from being able to accomplish everything he wants.
On every turn, yeah.
Wasn't Tyrion better than just instantly losing to the board? Oh, you don't use Shadows, never mind.
Yeah, the Ardent Squire is the only thing that remains, but it's so easy for that deck to pair any damage, whether it's just a weapon, another Consecrate themselves, if they run the Avenging Wrath, if they have a Charger, a buff.
Yeah, not much Trump could really do. We do even see the proof of the plays working out a bit there, with like Sylvanas kind of, you know, being less flexible at least. So even though Trump had some fairly difficult plays to make, I think he made them all just fine. It's just the way the deck plays is not really quick enough in this matchup.
Yeah, all right. Well, I mean, I guess on the plus side, we get to see if Paladin can actually match up against the field a little bit better, because that was, you know, pretty much a stomp from one side. The fact that the aggressive Paladin has a pretty big edge over them. But taking a look at the rest of the classes, we do have, you know, Warlock, Mage, Hunter. How do you feel like Paladin stacks up against those classes? Because we know how Paladin does against the regular classes of like Rogue or Patient Warrior. Do you?
I think it's good versus Warlock. It should be good versus Hunter. It's really bad versus Freeze Mage. It can win versus Rogue, probably even more than Priest does, and we see Priest already won. And versus Patron, you can outcard them if they don't get good Battle Rages and good early game value. And also Quartermaster is really insane in that matchup. So Paladin is decent, I guess, but it's probably the weakest deck that Value Town has right now.
Okay. Okay, well, we'll see if that ends up being the case. Remember, if Trump loses again, or say Value Town sends out Trump, we do have something called the bench rule. Did you get benched last time? Last week?
No, I didn't. I think Colento got benched.
He's Colento the only player that got
I think he's the only player that got benched.
Oh, actually, one other person got benched too. I can't remember off the top of my head.
Oh, on the second day, perhaps?
Yeah, on the second day. It was just like unfortunate that it just kept happening there. But if you lose two in a row, right? You can't play until another player on your team wins. This is to avoid having one player just queue up, you know, five games in a row and try to just grab a win. And this way we all can see some diversity across the team. Like, you'll see every player play at least once.
Yeah,
it's pretty demoralizing losing for the team. It's like one thing losing for yourself because you can afford it sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you cannot change it, it's a card game, you still win and lose, but when you lose for the team, you feel something different. You're like, you wish you win. It's so bad going to your teammates and telling them that you lost, and that they have to carry you and win for you.
Well, they can't carry you all the way. You still have to win. Yeah, they have to carry you morally. It's like, you can do it, man. You got this. It was just some bad RNG, you know?
Yeah, that's the part where they shouldn't flame you. And for me, it was really good. They supported me, and I managed to get my win. For other teams, I don't know. Frodon said he has some stories.
No, I'm just saying that I've heard some stories. I'm not sure if they're true or not. Just rumors. Just rumors.
Well, we're gonna have to hear what you heard when it's the right time. Yeah,
later on. You'll have to watch the NRDU. Is it Tice that's the most supportive of you? Because every time I see you and Tice at tournaments, it's always like you guys are coaching each other and trying to keep the mindset clear.
All the team, Life Coach Tice and also Lothar, were really supportive.
Nice.
Good. Oh man, that force knowledge. Okay.
Well, with this, I believe we're going to see all six players in the first three games. Pretty much what the people came to see.
How did Forsen perform? Oh, sorry.
Forsen, I think he's going to play Freeze Mage. And Brian Kibler, if he's keeping the Hunter from last week, he will be like heavily favored versus Freeze Mage.
Mm-hmm. Forsen last week, to answer your question, Krip, he went 2-0. He played his games very quickly. I believe it was Forsenboys against Templestorm, and Forsenboys was up 5-0.
Yeah.
Where Oskaka, Forsen, and Chalky were able to grab their wins very quickly. And then Oskaka had to just win with Druid, and then Templestorm almost reverse swept it. It was pretty cool. But Forsen also got a very bad matchup on paper. He had Freeze Mage versus Druid, and he was able to take that win. So it wasn't like, you know, Forsenboys had it easy in terms of the road there. Forsen had to overcome a pretty big obstacle. And if RDU's prediction is correct, and you know, Kibler is playing a similar Hunter last week, and he is favored, once again, Forsen's Freeze Mage is not in a very favorable position in this matchup.
Right. Kibler was in a very similar situation. He just, like, I think he played the first and third game and won both of them immediately in pretty short amount of time.
Yeah.
So both these players are actually so far undefeated in the Archon team tournament.
That's true.
Did we see Kibler keeping Loteb in his starting hand?
I missed that.
I think that if he kept Loteb, is like pretty bad for Forsen. Because he became predictable. Like, if Forsen would have brought an aggressive mage, a tempo mage or flamewaker mage, he would just like insta-win versus Kibler just because Kibler kept Loteb. But Kibler was sure Forsen is like 100% going to play Freeze Mage if he decided to keep the Loteb.
Yeah, I think this is something that everyone's pegged on the Forsen boys, because all three players on that team love Freeze Mage. You see Chalky bringing it to tournaments very often, even though he's known as an aggressive player. Oskaka's brought Freeze Mage a ton. That's how he also got far in some tournaments. And Forsen, I mean, he's played Freeze Mage more than almost anybody in competitive tournaments, in terms of from what my memory serves. So I think that's certainly something that's a really good point, RDU. You don't want to become too predictable, because then you start skewing the percentages a little bit in your favor, because you can start cornering decks and lineups a little bit more.
Now, what do you think about the silence on the Mad Scientist? It seemed like the most damage play that you could make was the second juggler and then the abusive. Do you think it's better to kind of control the draw, essentially, by denying the secret?
I think that he should have probably went for the juggler. You get more juggles out, and it's a bigger chance to kill Scientist, therefore protecting your juggler. And I think juggler is more important than stopping your opponent from getting a secret now. You can still use the owl later on, on either unfreezing one of your minions or just denying another secret. So yeah, your suggested play is probably better, Creep.
Okay. Well, Kibler's still in really good spot here. Just charge into the face and hero power the face every turn. And it looks like clear sailing.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's still like ice barrier and ways to stall. And the thing about decks that have a lot of chargers and hunters that you have to activate them eventually, because that's your main source of damage. So if there's ways for Forsen to eventually grab ways to stall the board and pick up some of his key cards to flip the matchup, like Alexstrasza's or anything that can help him stabilize, and there's still a chance for Forsen to pull us out here. Look at that, back at 19. Everything's easy peasy. He just basically gained a couple of turns back into this game. And he also has Antonitis. Maybe that can help convert too.
I think he gained less than one turn. I think Kibler does more than 8 damage this turn. Yeah, he's doing 9 this turn.
Yeah, he has to go for the Wolf Rider.
Yeah.
You want a hero power every turn. As you said, creep. It's really important in this matchup.
Also, you know, the 1 health minions are a bit weak against the slower mage decks, which obviously Freeze Mage is. So to punish them, you want to play as many 1 health minions at the same time as possible so they get attacks in. And with 1 health minion on the board right now, it may work out. Okay, because of the Lothab here.
Lothab before turn 8 is usually like a really powerful play if you can guarantee Lothab hits and you can pop or you can threaten lethal damage, whether they have Ice Block up or not. I remember last week when reviewing some games, Gara was just like, you know, lecturing other teammates about like how to play certain things. And he says Lothab, before turn 8 is probably the key, unless you're trying to block like a post Alexstrasza lethal on yourself if they're trying to go for a kill.
I would have liked the Wolf Rider more. Turn 6 is not such a key turn. I would much rather play Lothab on turn 7 for the Freeze Mage. You can push more damage that way.
Well, how much does he have now? He's got 7, 14. 12, 14 max out of 17.
Yeah. That's pretty close.
That's not bad considering that Haunted Creeper will also stick onto the board.
It's actually 16 because the Leprenom dies.
Oh, you're right.
It's one off.
Wow, that's really close.
He just goes for it. Wow.
Sure.
That's pretty risky, I would say. I like it.
I mean, I think you really can't go wrong either way. I like that Kibler went for a charger now in case he has a second ice barrier, so this Wolf Rider won't give him a second chance to have another secret being out. And in this case, look, the ice barrier was drawn. And then now he can use Kill Command just as simply a way to get him down to 1 with the hero power and then threaten him 2 turns in a row.
Also in this position, if you're Force and you know you're going to die next turn to something, it's just like you have to manage risk a little bit. So if you feel you're kind of screwed anyway, I think you'd actually play the ice barrier this turn.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. I think he really wants to search for his Alexstrasza, or if he's running a heal bot, like he needs to get some sort of draw out here. But the problem also exists where he can't necessarily part ways with the coin comfortably because his coin is his key to play Alexstrasza next turn. But he can't do that and develop Ice Block at the same time, so he's got to make some choices here.
He pings the Acolyte. I would have liked just Acolyte and then Ice Block. Because you can just draw Alexstrasza off the top and coin Alexstrasza. Now you have to coin into Ice Block. And if he has a way to proc your Ice Block, the only way that you win is getting the second Ice Block and then Alexstrasza, which is like a much lower chance than just getting Alexstrasza.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if there's anything that Hunter really constitutes as like a draw they want other than insurance against Alexstrasza. So Quick Shot is nice because it's more damage that can help him refill the hand and get burned back just in case his opponent bounces back health, but you know your opponent also just used a coin, so Alexstrasza is out of the case here.
And very important to not play the Haunted Creeper there. If you do, you just kind of give more options to Forsen.
Yep, also very true.
Forsen wants a card, he has to invest that 2 mana, and right now you want the mage to be restricted on every single point in the game.
I mean, maybe even Arcane Intellect because there's only 1 more mana for an extra card, and you still want that heal bot if possible. If he even has it. I mean, I don't even know what's in his deck with 30 cards for 30 cards.
We've seen the heal bot, I think, in recent times. Mm-hmm. Forsen is a player who is using that.
I don't think he has a heal bot because if he had it, he had Arcane Intellect before pinging. Because you draw 2 cards and not 1. And now, he lost.
Well, I mean, he always might feel like, he's just drawing more cards to see what his deck provides then.
That's usually a bad idea. Because if the next card would be Alex or Ice Block, he would just yield himself more.
Fair enough, fair enough. Kipler remains undefeated in the Archon Team League so far, coming at 3-0. And taking a win with Hunter versus Freeze Mage. And you could say it's fortuitous matchup, but I actually really like the way he played that, from his mulligans to keeping Lotheb and putting Force on Freeze Mage. I know you said that you really liked that play for going for the Creeper instead of the Wolf Rider, but I think I really like the lines that Kibler took. It made a lot of sense given the context of the hands of the matchup.
Yeah, certainly the decisive play was to keep Lotheb, and it really helps further that pressure that you really need as the Hunter in that matchup. And yeah, he made it work. Got the win. Good enough. And Forsen is no longer undefeated.
That's right. Forsen has his first loss, but I think he's going to be okay. Forsen's actually gotten pretty good at handling his emotions. I think when I first saw him in Fight Night, you were there too.
Yeah,
Crip. It's like he was definitely more of like, you know, a pretty emotional player sometimes with his reactions and stuff. But he seems to be pretty calm nowadays.
Yeah, he felt really crushed at some of the moments, especially because back then, a lot of players still had room to innovate new decks for big tournaments. And he was one of those players that really pushed that. Now, we don't really see that these days anymore. The most exciting thing that we really see are tournaments with interesting rules, basically like this one. But you know, when you take a risk like that, when you're like, hey guys, trust me, this deck works, and then you lose with it constantly.
Yeah.
That's gotta hit pretty hard.
Well, what Crip's talking about is back in the day, Forsen played the weirdest gimmick decks in the world, ever. It was like Druid would have Ysera and Faceless. So it was like a super greedy ramp deck, but also had Molten Giants and like Mark of the Wilds. So he'd play like two Moltons, or he'd play like one Molten, Faceless one of them when they have a Mark of the Wild, and like play Ysera or something, like all for like 11 mana with Innervate. It was really weird and stupid, but it actually won again the game, which was hilarious.
One of the other decks that I remember specifically was it was similar to that. It was the Faceless Ancestral Spirit Earth Elemental Shaman that ran Sunwalkers and two Farsights.
Yeah,
so if you Farsight into like one of the combo pieces, you could do Earth Elemental, Ancestral Spirit, and Faceless all in the same turn.
Mm-hmm.
And basically lock out the game. Because back then, it was a different game.
Oh yeah, man. Zoo and Face Hunter was really starting to get popular and whatnot. So he just wanted to go super taunts to try to lock out any of that from happening. Now we're going over to Kibler versus Forsen again. It's Freeze Mage versus Druid. Thought maybe we just queued up the same screen. So once more.
Oh, Ram Druid. I think Freeze Mage is actually favored versus Ram Druid. Forsen also played this matchup quite a lot, from what I know. So he will be favored to win this.
Right. I guess the question becomes a few things of like, if Kibler is running like two Savage Roars in this deck, because I know some ramps cut one of them. I actually really don't like lists that cut the combo altogether, because I think it's too greedy and assuming that you can get away with it. But if he's only running one Savage Roar, it becomes even more difficult, like you said, RDU.
Do you think we will see an Angriff this game?
An
Angriff tree? Angriff is the German 10-5 cast of Ancient of War.
Oh, the uprooted Ancient of War. Gotcha. I had no idea, man. You're so multilingual, Crip. You speak
I learned English, that from Trump's
Romanian.
Stream,
you speak dank memes, and now you speak German.
Yeah.
Dank memes must be the best language ever.
Yeah, he could go for it right now at 10-5. And it would be answered by a Frostbolt, consequently, but it'd be hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, if there was no Frostbolt, it would get 10 damage in.
Yeah.
I'm actually surprised he didn't go for it. I mean, you have no hand with that, basically.
It can get Fireballed, or like Frostbolt ping.
Well, it couldn't get Fireballed on 3, you'd get 10 damage in, and that would be worth it. You drain a Fireball, you do 10 damage, and you waste turn 4 on the Mage to slow down the draw.
Well, there is something to consider too. Druid's hero power is pretty relevant in this matchup, and we do emphasize it a lot, but it only matters if you can continue the pressure. So if you put up the hero power a lot and you gain some armor, so that way when they put Alexstrasza onto you, you still have 18, 19, maybe even more health. Mm-hmm. That's only relevant if you can keep pressuring to pop the ice block and remove the board. And Ramp Druid, is we all know, is slower because you're trying to play big threats one at a time. So as much as it might be important for Druid generally to keep up that armor gain, it's only relevant as much as you can to potentially kill the Freeze Mage.
I'm surprised he's bringing up Ancient of War this turn. It just felt like last turn it would have worked out a little bit better. He would have also had the follow-up play with the Big Game Hunter.
I think it was because he wants to... He probably has a lot of 5-drops in his deck, and so he's leveraging the coin on whatever he draws next, mm-hmm. so that way he can coin it out or he can just play something for 4.
Forsen can now abuse his Acolytes. That's a really good play, attacking, because you play around the Keeper of the Grove.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can go like Acolyte ping and guarantee yourself at least one draw. And if he has Keeper, he uses Keeper on Acolyte, and then he'll probably not Keeper the Emperor. Emperor is going to get like huge value.
Yeah, well, what about this Ancient of Lore smacking for 5 damage a turn, though? He can remove it over the course of a Frostbolt Fireball, but that is a investment on the hand, plus whatever he develops the following turns, you're still going to be taking damage from.
He's not such a big threat, right?
Well, apparently it's threatening enough.
Threatening enough to use one Ice Lens, but not the Frostbolt.
Whoa, oh, that's a draw.
Nice draw.
Well, a 5-drop would have been really good too. And yeah, I think like half of the deck was good draws. But Shredder was one of the better ones.
I think Pilot Shredder is even slightly better than a 5-drop because it does around the same damage on average. Like, it's the same damage as a Druid of the Claw, but it's more resilient, which is the key thing to some of these decks.
Ooh, do you mill here? You can mill the mage. You can Wrath for 1.
Can you?
Yeah, Wrath for 1, hero power, and then... Because you're not really playing anything significant anyway.
Is that worth it?
We'll see. Is if it burns Alexstrasza. If it burns anything else...
I think Thalnos is a pretty big burn too.
Okay.
I think that it's worth milling your opponent, only if you know the game is going to go to fatigue.
Oh, one card off!
Yeah.
Alexstrasza sandwiched by 2 blizzards and it clips the second one.
No, you're absolutely right. It's just a very flashy thing to do. Like, you know, you get to mill your opponent, but you go on the very small chance that you burn something significant, and that Acolyte's going to draw a second card anyways. So I agree with what Crip was saying. I think Kibler wants to develop his hand a little bit better, like draw a card and mill. So I think it served multiple purposes. It wasn't like, well, I can mill and I'm going to make that my primary game plan.
I would say it was not really worth it. I'm not sure if this matchup goes to fatigue. And this way you guarantee Forsen the draws that he wanted. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, if you don't mill Alex, you're pretty much losing because you give the Freeze Mage a potential full hand for Emperor.
Yeah. Now here I think we're going to see a Wrath for 1 into Swipe. Swipe's a nice card. I mean, it lets you be flexible with damage from hand, which is really the strength of Druid. But I don't see a better answer for it.
You know, actually, I realized that Kibler, I think, was 1 damage off from potentially killing his opponent, right? Because he had Swipe and Savage. Wait, he's 2 Savage Roars now! Oh, but he can't afford it. Yeah. So his opponent needs to have Ice Block soon.
You can just freeze Ice Barrier.
Oh, that's right. Blizzard's now 5.
And then he can... Would you just YOLO Alexstrasza next turn, being Forsen? You have enough to lethal him if he doesn't kill you through the Ice Barrier.
I feel like it really depends on what the board looks like after next turn. If he plays, you know, Shade and another Pilot Shredder, I think that's really scary to just drop Alexstrasza on, because you have 18 health and there'd be, you know, 16 damage on board. I think that's too risky. But I was saying, but that's not the case here. Kib is going to develop 1 minion here. I think Zombie Chow is off limits for sure, right?
You also know, yeah, like, 9 mana is available. That's kind of a big deal. Because, you know, he hasn't coined yet.
Well, that's an excellent point. I mean, I don't think he even necessarily needs the full combination. One Savage Roar is still an insane amount of damage here. It's 21 just with one Savage Roar.
I would say it was a really key thing that Kibler punched his face to test for secrets, because now Forsen cannot bluff the ice block, and he has to deal with the board in some way or another.
Well, he can actually put a second ice barrier up now and gain even more health, bounce up to 25.
That's not enough.
Well, what if you ice barrier flame strike?
That may be enough.
Well, it depends on what comes out of Shredder, right? Because you're still not dead to a combination of Force of Nature, Savage Roar, unless something of significant power comes out of that Shredder.
Yeah, we could see, like, a Whirling Zap-O-Matic tragedy here.
It's the sickest thing ever when Whirling Zap-O-Matic gets 7 damage off 2 Savage Roars and it just goes insane.
Yeah.
Let's see. 5, 6. Okay, not enough. Man, that Mana Worm, though. Or Mana Wraith, excuse me, that Mana Worm.
This way he's not playing around combo, but he had no way to play around combo, so he chose the line of play that gives him the draw next turn, so he goes closer to his Ice Block. He basically needs Ice Block into playing Alexstrasza, and then just bursting Kibler down. But Kibler maintains the pressure up, so this is going to be really hard for Forsen.
Let's see. If you have... there's no secret up, right?
No, there's no secret up. No.
So would you be willing to use Druid of the Claw Savage Roar now? And because you already have another Druid of the Claw Savage Roar the following turn anyways. And that is 12 damage, and you put him down to 5. Is that too risky considering that Thanos is on the board already?
Thanos is a pretty good card. But I'm not sure if he's that great.
I think we'll probably see Druid of the Claw in Taunt, actually.
Okay.
Isn't Charge better than Taunting, usually, versus Freeze Mage in this spot?
Usually it is, but, you know, of course you're not playing around Flame Strike. So the inner arena specialist in Crypt is cringing right now.
He's gonna die to Flame Strike now.
What do you think this? What do you think of Flame Strike and then Arcane Intellect? Like Arcane Intellect and then Flame Strike? Because you know he doesn't have combo.
So greedy though.
If he had combo, he would have won last turn. So you know he doesn't have combo. And Forsen has this kind of thinking. Like if he didn't use it, he doesn't have it.
Yeah.
He goes for the really good play. I like this a lot.
You can actually instead of just Flame Strike, you can just Doomsayer, Freeze here.
That place
just
is bad.
Freeze.
It's bad just Freeze. You like just freezing?
Well, if he ends up going for the Keeper on the Doomsayer, that's another Flame Strike target.
Oh.
Well, he does have combo. and he ends up developing Ice Bear. So he ends up like doing the hedge play where it's like half safe, but also half greedy with drawing cards here. And what's really powerful to follow this up is that Kibler also has more ways to damage from the hand, like a second Druid of the Claw Savage Roar. Mm-hmm. So whatever minion ends up sticking. And this will be
Kibler's
5.
Like, health. So he's not dead again. Okay.
Yeah.
Do you think it was good to start with the face? If it was Ice Block, it was probably better to just go double trends and then using the face to let him at 2 and not at 4. As I said, just a small thing.
Yeah, it'd probably be better. If he knew that.
Wait, no, I think he would have gotten to 1 with that play. Because at this. Okay, so he took 14. What to do? Right?
Yes.
So it was at 19 total health?
Yes.
So it was at 11? If he was at 11, you want to do face first, put him to 9. First train puts him at 5. Second one puts him at 1. Third one procs block at 1.
I think he was at 12.
I think his play was correct in both situations.
Okay.
Fair enough, fair enough. Is he... is he dead no matter what he does here? Because his opponent has a Druid of the Claw.
Yeah, I believe so. He has to kind of draw to another option, but he has no draw in his hand right now. So it looks like Forsen is gone. Looks like Kibler remains undefeated 2 weeks of Archon League.
That's right. Well, unless barring any catastrophe where Kibler doesn't see this lethal, but Druid of the Claw Sanador should be in. Well, look, I mean, there's always been the case where we can come to those assumptions, and sometimes...
Oh, no, he has to play the Keeper. The never lucky.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, well, Kibler's done for the day and the week.
And Forsen's done for now. Forsen is benched, and that's two losses in a row.
Forsen got benched. Oh, man, I got to update this in the...
From undefeated to benched.
That's a pretty good advantage for... Team Value Town now, because they know what to expect and they know what to not play against.
Yeah,
that's right. We only have Rogue, Warrior, and Hunter as a possibility for Team Forsenboys. And also Team Forsenboys was also really confident coming out to week number two. They had a really good showing in week one, defeating Temple Storm. And they were feeling really confident because the way it happened, it's like, well, you know, we won five straight games and then Druid kind of struggled a little bit, but it happens because Druid has that draw wild, growth, or bust type of mentality. But it's not going so smoothly now, as the overlay says it's 2-1, but it's actually 3-1 as Dog Kibler, Dog Kibler and Kibler took three games here.
Now that I think about it, it seems that as a team, perhaps the strategy was not very good to send out Forsen, because if he does win the game, I mean, sure, he wins the game, but so can anyone else. But if he loses a game, he's benched, and the other team is restricted to three classes, as you said. So it seems like you're taking a senseless risk at the early stage of the tournament.
Can I make a prediction?
Oh, okay. Go ahead, RD. I was going to make one, but I like to hear yours.
I would like to say that the Dog will go for Rogue, because he knows that he's not going to face Freeze Mage. And if Team Forsenboys predicts that, they will either go for Chucky's Hunter, if it's Face Hunter, or for Oskaka's Control Warrior or Patron Warrior to try to counter the Rogue. Mm-hmm. That's what I think is going to happen, because Team Value Town will try to make use of Forsen being benched and not play around Freeze Mage or Zoo.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. I was going to bring up the same, but maybe even talk about Paladin too, because Paladin would struggle against Freeze Mage, like you said. But in this case, it's not going to be an answer to the Rogue directly. It'd be a Rogue versus Rogue with Oskaka versus Dog.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Call the ambulance. Uh-oh. It's bad news for Forsenboys.
Maybe they think Rogue is the best answer to Rogue.
There's no way that is the case.
Maybe Oskaka's Rogue runs Harrison or something like that.
Okay. It seems like you were right with Dog picking Rogue, but again, like even if Harrison is in there, isn't that pretty close to a 50-50? Because you still have to get the card.
Yeah, it is. Maybe just they didn't think about it, or they just random picked, which is correct. But in the situation of a player being benched, I think you can try to pick. Of course, now that everybody's going to watch, and if somebody from us is going to be picked, they will know how I think and try to counter us. So there's like a lot of mind games going on.
Okay. Yeah, that's a really good point, RDU, because in the end, you can play Nash Equilibrium, right? And then you can also just randomize it, and then it equals out to be 50-50 either way. Yep. So I think the key here is just that if Value Town does get the win, though, they're in a really good spot, because then they just ride Trump all the way home, right?
And his also the thing...
Or not. Or they can just ride that mid-range Paladin all the way down.
To the gutters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, Frodon, the thing you said about mid-range Paladin, it has a really bad matchup thrown away, the Freeze Mage, but also the best matchup, possibly, the Zoo one from Forsen, because I expect Forsen is going to play Zoo. Thrown away. So, like, you don't really want to go for the Paladin. So, it was pretty obvious that Value Town is going to play Rogue.
Damn, it was obvious.
Like, they had to do that. They are pretty forced to do that.
Yeah. Fair enough. All right. Taking a look at how this opening hands look. Dog's hand looks fairly aggressive. He's got the two weapon buffs plus Eviscerate and Blade Flurries. And his opponent looks like it's more, it's a little bit slower, but it's more board centric. Look, Dog equipping a Deadly Poison here. Now, so Artie, this is like a really intricate matchup, and I know you love talking a lot about it. So he's just trying to answer whatever comes out, like if it's a Pilot Shredder or it's a Violet Teacher, right? By equipping this Deadly Poison out early.
Yeah, you want to equip Deadly Poison early if you can, if you have a spare mana. You also don't want to play the naked Violet Teacher because she can get destroyed by Deadly Poison SI. At the same time, you don't really want to play Shredder because he can get destroyed by Sap. You want to use Prep as early as possible, even with the Sprint. Like, if I would get Prep Sprint, I would probably keep that in the starting hand because it's such a good tempo, just gaining the cards early. Because at one point, you will have to Sprint. So if you Sprint on turn 4, you can afford to not Sprint all the rest of the game. And when your opponent will Sprint himself, you can just destroy him by making a power play on turn 7.
This guy's a toast.
But yeah, seeing often... that... sorry, continue.
Honestly, you often see that like turn where they have to Sprint and just lose the game from there immediately if they don't draw like a Blade Flurry combo.
Yeah, Blade Flurry combos are something you need to play around in this matchup because you know that your opponent is going to have them at some point or another. Donald's backstab is pretty inefficient, so he'll probably coin SI. Oh, Farseer, sorry.
He's saving that that weapon shard so he can get big Blade Flurry next turn, or like for a better value on the Sharpsword Oil?
Yeah, he just wants a bigger weapon. And I guess what RDU was saying about Harrison potentially being in Oskaka's deck does seem to be like a huge advantage. It's just... You still need to draw the card. You still need it in the right spot. So even like a really powerful tech card like that, you know, I think the most you're going to get out of that is like a 5% advantage.
You think so? Isn't it like a really huge tempo swing to get Harrison?
Yeah, but you actually need to draw Harrison and play it in the right spot. Like the chance of that is not that high.
Yeah.
Oh.
But we can keep it in the mill again.
Yeah.
Lodev is pretty huge.
What an just awkward denies, hand.
Yeah, it denies the whole turn. I think you have to trade Talos and try to draw into a play. Any play.
Do you have to trade Talos? It seems like you have so much stuff that's affected by spell damage that just going face might require your opponent to spend 3 damage killing Talos.
At least. It is true. He's got equipped a Deadly Poison. He'd have to have a fan of knives for it to be card efficient to deal with Thanos, but maybe not even mana efficient.
He cannot really afford to skip turn 5, so going for the draw is a really good play. She should value, like, even his opponent using 3 damage to kill his Thanos, is it that worth it?
If it's a weapon, yeah, it might be. But like, what's the chance he actually draws something that's playable? So you have the Azure Drake, you have your own Lotheb, you have maybe a Piloted Shredder or two. Is there anything else? Like an SI doesn't really do anything. That just dies to the weapon the same as Thanos would.
So he basically had to like value if it's better to go for the 30% or 20-something percent to draw into an out that he can play, or just pass the turn and trade Thanos for a free damage dagger 100% of the time.
Is it even 20%? That's kind of what I'm asking.
It's close to that, I think.
It's probably like 4. Yeah, I think it's about 20, maybe a little bit less.
So he either went for the 20%
yeah,
or just 100%. I think you have to go for the high risk, high reward plays, at least in this format where you have to win with only 2 decks.
Well, it worked out. I mean, it baited out the fan, and he would have drawn an antique Healbot.
Yeah, Healbot was pretty bad there. He could like trade a weapon and then Healbot. Semi-kill the Lotheb.
Yeah, here we're gonna see a prep oil, and I think he's just gonna face into Lotheb.
I think he goes face.
Okay. Yeah.
He shows his opponent he has Blade Flurry, but does he really care? Like, if his opponent is not gonna play any monster, he still wins. And now Oskaka is probably gonna play Deckhand and Tinker Avis and just go for face himself. It's a face battle.
I mean, when you have this much damage, though, Oscar, I mean, if you can count each oil as 6 damage, plus the 8 from Eviscerate and the 2 from from the Thanos, that's 22 damage. So it's like, that's a lot. Plus the oil lands on a minion, forgot about that. So that's 9 damage that you can kind of count in. That's pretty ridiculous, I think. So there should be a race turned on here, at least from Oskaka's end, because his hand is basically telling him to go aggressive.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
He goes for the oil play. I wonder if it hits the deckhand, is it better to trade the deckhand or just eviscerate it still? I think it's still better to eviscerate it.
It's always probably better to eviscerate.
Multiple threats, yeah.
Double healbot. Interesting.
Oh yeah. Man, second healbot.
I don't think you'd ever actually sacrifice the deckhand there. It's absolutely not worth it because you're just saving eviscerate for face later on. And you might as well just hit 5 for face with the deckhand.
Yeah. The Bullrun double
healbots everywhere. Oh my goodness.
It makes Rogue more consistent if you think about it, and that's what the deck needs. But Rogue needs more card draw, more consistent card draw. Since Auctioneer went nerfed,
it also kind of needs struggles. More healing. I mean, Rogue is the only deck that uses Earthen Ring Farseers anymore, right?
Yeah, not even Hanlok uses them anymore.
Yeah.
I think Maligos Warlock still uses Earthen Ring Farseers. But we didn't see that deck being played for a lot of time because it just loses to Patron, and there are not that many Hanloks in the meta.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. They put an anti-Killbot, which is like a minion that's supposed to like help out control decks and stuff, but then it costs 5 mana, so it doesn't really help out control decks very much.
It's just a really good anti-aggro tool. He misses the 50-50 for 3 more damage. Unlucky.
7 damage weapon, though. Looks like he's gonna get flurried pretty hard here, though.
You cannot really play around the second flurry.
It's unlikely.
This is how the Rogue mirrors usually go. Just flurries back and forth. Healbots, Azu Drakes. It's a really aggressive tempo battle. Also race-ish. Like, they try to see who has the most damage in a fast amount of time.
Oh my god.
So we'll see all 4 flurries this game. And we'll also see just like a lot of cards being drawn here. Unless Oskaka wants to go for the Azudrake for the board presence, but I think Sprint here is the better option.
Sprint is better because you can draw into a Farseer. Oh, he runs Harrison indeed.
Wow.
So maybe that's why they thought it's better to go for Rogue versus Rogue.
Yeah, but again, he didn't draw it in time. I mean, like, all the weapon cards are basically out at this stage.
Yeah, as you said, Creep, like 5% probably was right. As you said it. Harrison doesn't add that much. You have to draw him at the same time. Your opponent has a weapon.
He's so close to potentially killing his opponent, too. Lotheb will be really key, too, if you can shut down his opponent's spells. And he can gather damage. Because the key is he just doesn't actually have damage to kill his opponent unless his Azudrake sticks.
At this point, Lotheb is probably the best card you can draw.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if we'd see Oskaka drawing Lotheb now, he would just win. And if he doesn't play Lotheb or something powerful now, Dog is going to play Lotheb himself and put Oskaka in a bad spot.
Is the play here to Drake and Blade Flurry?
Do you have anything else? Not really.
I don't think Sap even allows you to do anything else. Like, Sap usually helps you gain tempo to do something on the board in combination with it, but it doesn't really do anything here. It lets you keep your weapon, so if he plays Drake again and he can't kill you, then you can Blade Flurry.
Well, you can Blade Flurry and re-weapon up an attack just to push for a little bit extra damage.
That also works.
And then maybe you can draw into something from Harrison.
Yeah, but not gonna happen here. Sap and Lotheb and SI7 agent. I think that's gonna be it.
I don't see us getting out of this.
There's no card that really pulls Rogue out here that's in the traditional oil Rogue deck. Is there? No, there's nothing.
Like, maybe Healbot can let you survive. We have the second Healbot, but other than that, I wouldn't see any other card.
If there was no Lotheb, though, I mean, look at some of the plays available to Oskaka this turn. It would have been crazy.
There's really nothing Oskaka can do to prevent lethal. There is, if he assumes that Eviscerate is not in the hand of Dog, but it is. I think considering that, there's nothing to be done. Even if he gets Healbot from Azure Drake, it's not good enough. Even if he saps Lotheb, it's not good enough.
That's right. And it's not like there's anything else he can draw with Azure Drake that could help pull him out here either.
Let's see.
Nope.
Certainly not that.
Not preparation for five, at least. That's it. Valleytown goes up 4-1. And Kibler and Dog are done for the day, meaning that Team Captain Trump is going to have to take home the victory here. He has to win with his Paladin and his Warrior up against pretty much anybody. Oh, no. Actually, Forsen's still benched, right? Because
yes,
no, we have to see benched. A member of Forsenboys actually win in order to get Forsen off the bench.
Yeah.
Because he's ice cold right now.
So that means that Trump is going to go for Warrior, which says Oskaka is going to go for Rogue, most likely. It's going to be a really hard spot for Trump, knowing his teammates went 2-0. It's a really bad spot. The more games you lose, the more tilted you go, usually. I don't think Trump is the person that is going to go on tilt.
Yeah.
But it's going to be hard.
Everyone kind of snaps a little bit, don't you think?
Yeah. When you have to lose for the team, it's hard.
Yeah, it's especially when because like Trump probably convinced his teammates that it's like, hey guys, this mid-range Paladin is really good. Trust
yeah,
me.
Kind I'm not going to bring Warlock. I'm going to bring Paladin.
Yeah. Wait, so you have
consider Warlock to be one of the best decks in Conquest. So.
Right. You have a few of these like added pressure dynamics that kind of contribute to perhaps some tilt, perhaps some rushed or bad play. So I wouldn't be too surprised if we do see it from May himself, but... Well, I hope not.
I don't think so. I think if there's anything I've learned from witnessing the rap battle yesterday with Trump, that he doesn't get rattled easily. I think people can throw some mean words or even tough situations, but the mayor of Valleytown will come through once again. And you know, one thing, too, is that Trump's gotten a lot of experience. I think back in the past when we were first watching him play Fight Night and Trump was still getting used to the spotlight of being one of the guys that people look to in Hearthstone, he was still feeling a lot of that pressure. Remember in Fight Night, he couldn't win at all, Grip, until like his very last match, I think, where he finally got a win with that weird mage deck. That was like a big key moment for Trump to be like, wow, I finally won. But since then, I think he's certainly been able to be a lot more calm and collected in competitive.
Well, it's going to have to be. It is Paladin versus Warrior. This seems pretty unusual. But what also is pretty interesting is that it is Oskaka coming out again. I believe if he loses...
He's Trump, benched.
Trump knows exactly who he's playing against.
Oh, so that's the... I guess that's the logic then. If you play Paladin, you can directly corner that Hunter with the Warrior deck. Although it's probably Patron, right? I don't know if Trump would be busting out the Control Warrior right now.
Control Warrior is coming back. Control Warrior ended number one on Europe. The double role Control Warrior is definitely something viable in a Patron meta, but I'm not sure if in the six deck format is the best call, because you're going to be vulnerable to so many things, like Druids or even Midrange Paladin.
I have to say that watching this tournament so far, it's even though some teams have had like a good head start, it's been like a very unfavorable like finish. So the last few matches, you kind of have to win some bad ones. But it seems the way things have been set up here is that Valleytown's really doing all right all the way to the end here. And it just seems like the bench rule is really... perhaps even benching Forsenboys out of the tournament today.
Let's see.
Oh, Crib. Very eloquent.
Let's not go that far. Let's see how good Midrange Paladin is.
That's true. I mean, Conquest, you're only as good as your weakest deck, so to speak. Maybe not necessarily weak in power level, but in terms of how it matches up. If this Paladin goes 0-6, I mean, that's another story in itself. But I don't anticipate that happening. Paladin's one of those decks... it used to be compared to Druid, in fact, because it just falls into wins based off its curve and having really powerful tempo plays that can't get stopped because a deck's bound to draw poorly against Paladin eventually.
That's right. It's a pretty nice hand from Osaka. He's mainly just missing the draw.
Yes, this is the patron warrior, the grim patron warrior, which people are starting to, you know, a little tweak here and there, but also people aren't loving it as much as they used to because they're starting to realize how to play better against the grim patron warrior. People are very cautious about leaving things with less than three attack on the board. People are teching in very aggressively against weapons, sometimes even going as far as, you know, acidic swamp ooze and the Harrison Jones to try to remove the double death spite. So I would assume that Trump is very you know, aware of the weaknesses of Paladin against Patron and will try to mitigate them accordingly.
All right. Well, we see the typical I'll play a dude on turn two and pass play.
Well, I mean, he wanted mini bot, but at least you get something on the board.
Mm-hmm. I think it's actually fine to play Muster here. It commits you to play the Owl next turn, but I don't think there's much wrong with that.
It might be wrong because when you see the unstable ghoul, you expect Acolyte of Pain and you want to Owl that usually to deny the draws from the patron player, because if the patron player gets for his draws, he just combos you and he wins.
Yeah, absolutely. Any combo deck in general, you just don't want them to draw, whether it's this deck or Miracle back in the day. What? Just no. Anything to keep them from being able to get the gas to put the fuel on.
Paladin is not the best deck to do that. He needs like perfect curve to be able to beat Miracle or to beat Patron nowadays. And we don't see Trump drawing that well this game.
Yeah, but what kind of play does Trump have this turn then?
Like, Consecration?
Well, I mean, you talked about him not playing the Owl. Like, he's basically committed to playing the Owl and the Acolyte, which is consistent with which is what you were saying, but that doesn't seem very good either.
It's okay.
It's actually pretty significant, though. It's not, maybe it's not good in the sense that you don't have a good board presence, considering that this, you know, this unstable will challenges everything. But yeah. Denying the draw is really big because after Warrior ends up using a lot of these resources, he's got a lot of like answers to stuff. But you have to remember that Paladin eventually will play bigger threats, mm-hmm. and he has to use these cards in order to get the board to stabilize.
Imagine though, he actually had a Grim Patron there. That would have been four Grim Patrons on the board already.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. Could have coined it out.
He opted to throw that away in the mulligan. I think it was a good decision because you don't really want to keep Green Patron in your starting hand unless you're facing another warrior.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Against Paladin, Green Patron is like usually a board clear mechanism. And getting the draw before you get to that mechanic into your deck is really important as well.
You can also just make four patrons on turn five and put them to have equality consecration. If they don't have both cards, you just mm-hmm. win.
It's really aggressive as well.
Opting to coin here to get a little bit of a bigger board at the end of the turn. He didn't have to coin. He could have just traded in the Acolyte. The Slam was probably getting value later on anyway. So I guess he thinks he doesn't really need to combo very quickly. And I think he's right in that assumption. The Paladin deck is a very strong deck, but it's a very slow deck. And generally, combo decks do well against any slow deck, regardless of the counters.
Well, Trump doesn't really have much to do here. Muster Her Battle is terrible in this scenario, so I guess you're just going to do the True Server Champion.
You could have went for Muster Her Battle if your opponent didn't have a board, because even if he makes patrons, you have Equality Consecration, but now he had board and he also had the weapon, which just deals with Muster.
Yeah, for sure.
But Trump might want to bait out Osaka to play the Patron combo on turn 8, because he has Equality Consecration. And if he deals with one Patron combo, then he just has one more. And if he deals with that, he's in a really good spot. That's the way Paladin wins, usually.
Wow. That's three pair, boys.
Yeah.
That sucks.
That's like, terrible considering that he needed to drop a threat and patron passing implies that he's got a lot of like situational combo pieces. So you'd like to be able to present something onto the board, but not really in this scenario.
Yeah, the reason two of the same cards is really bad in general is like you generally just want more options. often the only card you want more than once is like a direct damage card. Like if you're playing Hunter and you're doing okay, having two kill command is pretty good. But other than that, it's often a huge liability.
Well, Whirlwind Draw here is not exactly the most helpful. The thing is, Grim Patron is much better spot just passing than Paladin is, because Paladin can't really truly stop the combo from happening. And what's also really annoying, too, is that Paladin's hero power is naturally susceptible to things like Whirlwind clearing and also getting more damage onto the Frothing Berserker or even the Grim Patron, like you mentioned. So this is looking like Oskaka is pretty comfortable here, honestly, even though like nothing's really happening in the past couple turns.
Yeah, it's absolutely true.
At the same time, you expect Tyrion from the Paladin player on turn 8. So you're kind of afraid that if he plays Tyrion, you're in not such a good spot. But we see that he has Slam, so he can deal with that.
Yeah, he's in okay shape. Also because Trump would have to basically waste the True Silver Charge just to drop armor by 4. I mean, what you were talking about, Fred, is really the key. Trump is not the one who heals the warrior so he can't battle rage.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
And he's going to mill for 1. Man, Trump's hand was so bad. Yeah. But now he's got Dr. Boom, which is reasonable. But yeah, back to what you were saying, Trump's not the one who has to draw out like a 60 damage combo through taunt. Like, the Grim Patient Warriors, if you just give them enough time, you literally can't win.
Yeah, and time is what Oskaka has at the moment, but, I mean, he's also taking this turn. Like, this is something that I think players who are trying to make that jump into, the competitive scene, like, even though you're going to pass, start counting right now, like, what you can do on 9 mana, and just take the opportunity. So everyone's like, well, what's Oskaka doing? He's like making sure that if a card is played, how much damage do he have? He's got 3-4 whirlwind effects. Well, he only can use 3 because Frothing Berserker will die. But it's worth keeping count just in case.
If Trump goes for Dr. Boom and Minibot and he gets unlucky, Oseka probably has lethal with Frothing. If the bombs don't kill Frothing.
Or yeah. Or the other guys involved. Sometimes when you play Grim Patron versus Dr. Boom, the Grim Patron that just spawned dies, yeah, or the Warslung Commander dies, and it's awesome.
Well, you don't really care if Warsong dies.
Yeah, even the Warsong dies. It gives, with its last dying breath, it gives the Grim Patron charge.
Yeah, it depends how soon that happens, though. We've all seen the highlights where, against Dr. Boom, you see Warsong Commander, Grim Patron. Grim Patron goes into the bomb, and then the bomb immediately kills the Warsong, so you have one charging 3-3, which doesn't seem so overpowered anymore.
I think Trump doesn't want to play the mini-bot because it's just so resilient to things like Whirlwind, so he gets more damage. At least if he Whirlwinds, this 1-1 Silverhand Recruit will bite the dust and be only one additional damage for the Frothing Berserker. How much damage is this, are you? Use your elite mat skills.
You can get a Frothing to like 15 or 17, so like 20 something. It's not lethal.
Okay.
Wow. If the bomb, this deck sucks.
Only 15 damage. I mean, I can do that with Druid from the hand with only 2 cards.
Yeah.
You might want to play Patron. But your opponent has Equality Consecration, so you probably don't want. Emperor would be like the MVP here. The Boombots are annoying. At the same time, your opponent having a lot of minions on the board is the way you get lethal soon.
I like just the Execute here. Buy more time. You needed to play something, because otherwise you're going to mill next turn, and you're striving for more combo pieces, which Execute is not.
Is Master Quartermaster too greedy?
I feel like that's a little bit too many minions, just because it's 7 minions on the board, right? And then your opponent has like a full hand. If he has 2 Frothing Berserkers and a Warsong, and then he just like whirlwinds twice. That's an extra 28 damage because of four.
Yeah, Trump's, Trump's laughing right now. I mean, he realizes it's like, you know, okay, so I haven't played anything, but if I actually start to play stuff, I'll die.
Like, good old Unleash the Hounds.
Can Oskaka afford to use the weapon on the face and then play the frauding combo and still win? He probably can, because he has three whirlwind effects. Let me calculate it fast.
Not fast enough, are you?
Yeah, it's exactly lethal.
This is exactly
lethal. It's actually, no, it's 32 damage. If you go for face and then you play the combo. Because you deal 4 and then he has 5 monsters on the board, you will have 3. So that's like 8. You get the whirlwind twice. That's 16 on the frauding. Then you attack. Wait. It's 18 on the frauding. And then the...
It's more than 32. Because of inner rage and you can use the ghoul.
Oh, I didn't count inner rage. But yeah, it's lethal.
It's a pretty good deck. It's way, way, way more than lethal.
Pretty good deck. Actually, you might need to kill the unstable ghoul now. You can inner rage it.
Yeah.
Or you can enrage the Virtual Master in trade.
My enrage just adds nothing.
Well, it adds damage.
No.
Oh, I thought you can use it on the Frog Wizard.
No, but that's
absolutely. Oh, it's actually not lethal. Is it? It's not lethal.
Oh, he's three off.
Oh. Yeah, it's not lethal because the dudes were at 3 HP.
Yeah.
See, the last whirlwind is not as good as the other ones.
Wow. Damn it. Big Game Hunter was basically Iron Forge Rifleman.
So both me and Luskaka miscounted this.
But does he still have lethal next turn with
yeah,
6 damage? I think so.
Yeah, he has 8. 8 plus 3. Yeah.
Yeah.
Still 11. He has 11. I can do this math. I got it, guys.
I know why I miscounted. I didn't count the first whirlwind from the Death's Bite. I assumed he can do 4 whirlwinds and get max value and 4 whirlwinds. Whereas the first whirlwind doesn't matter because you have to use it to just clear the bombs. He would have had lethal if he would just YOLO it and risk frotting dying to bombs. That's it.
That would have never worked out.
You think so? They just hit face all the time.
When there's like this much on the line, the chance that you get unlucky is 100%.
100%?
100%.
That's right. Yeah. All right. Well, I think that's going to be it for game number 6. Forsenboys gets back onto the board, but most importantly, you know what this means? Forsen's unbenched, I believe.
Yeah.
You can get back in there.
That means that Trump is going to keep Paladin probably, and either Oskaka's Rogue or Forsen Freeze Mage is going to come out. I think Oskaka's Rogue is the best choice because you have good matchups versus either Paladin or Warrior, and you also like deal with Oskaka, so then like only Chucky and Forsen need to win.
Now, I should remind you guys watching that even though a team might lose, the points that they get in the losing position, they are relevant when it comes to tiebreakers at the end of the season. So even though like Value Town has a sizable lead here, if Trump is stuck on like Paladin as the last deck, you can bet Forsenboys are going to clean up with all the best matchups first before maybe they end up losing. And I feel that's largely a weakness with the Paladin. Like, if Trump saves the Paladin for last, that will absolutely happen because it has such bad matchups in some cases. Where the Grim Patient Warrior, well, not really. Nothing really, really beats Grim Patient Warrior. Certainly, it's no Paladin versus Freeze Mage matchup.
Yeah, so I was just looking at the classes as well. So I think you guys are pretty much right on. Well, I actually haven't seen Chucky been able to be played in a while, too, so I think it'd be nice to have him mix in if you expect Trump to be playing the Paladin. But
Forsen wants revenge. More
Forsen wants to get the win. I don't know, man. Do you think he thought long and hard during his time on the bench?
I don't know.
Towel over the head.
Maybe he's like, let me at him, let me at him. And then, you know, it's like, fine. We actually don't see what Trump has queued up with. There it is, Paladin. So, okay, so Forsell's going to get the win here. I think the chance the Paladin wins is maybe as bad as single digits.
Single digits?
Not really. They can curve out perfectly.
Okay, so you're saying basically like one out of every like 15 plus games the Paladin will win.
I've seen this matchup in tournaments like quite a few times, and I've never ever seen the Paladin win.
I've seen the Paladin win a few times, but
Strifecrow won last week. This matchup, yeah. exactly this matchup.
Really?
Yeah, he did.
With mid-range Paladin?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't see Strifecrow play mid-range Paladin. If I didn't see it, it didn't happen, guys.
That's yeah, cool. But the rules of Hearthstone don't necessarily apply to the gods like Strifecrow.
Yeah.
But I think, generally speaking, you're absolutely correct. I mean, any deck can win. Freeze Mage can draw really poorly. Paladin can draw excellently. And it's, you know, even if Freeze Mage draws poorly, generally can deal with Paladin. But don't also forget that there might be tech that we don't know from Trump that whips out randomly. Like, what if all of a sudden Trump decides to go full Asia region and just put Kazan Mystics in his deck? And we just didn't see it.
Yeah. Also, I feel this hand is pretty bad. Double Zombie Chow. Because they just don't really pay out in terms of like face damage. Like, Zombie Chow is great for board control, but there isn't much to control when it comes to the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I guess so. But if you... I mean, it is a body target for Blessing of Kings, so you can do enough damage with it, so that way...
That's true, Blessing of Kings. That is a great card. Oh, Force of Shaken has had like more ice barrier. Has it been 6 ice barriers now? I believe it has.
I haven't seen him really draw his Mad Scientist other than that one game where Kibbo silenced it. Seems like he's been drawing the Secrets instead.
Is it better to master for battle or just coin the kings?
No, if you coin kings, you get fireballed. You have to play master first.
Yeah, it's like the same damage anyways, if they survive and you kings next turn.
Yep.
Right?
Kings is more damage because it does the damage right away.
So with kings you do 4 now and 4 next turn. With master into kings you do 0 now and then next turn you do 8.
Okay.
So, should be the same.
Oh my goodness.
A little more.
Quartermaster. Right on curve.
That's the way you mean.
Not happy about that.
Wow. Okay. Okay, guys. The Paladin's totally favored in this matchup.
The chances of Freeze Mage winning, I think Crip said, was single digits.
No. I just had my chart upside down. So, you know, now we just flipped it around to see the truth of it.
I would say
gotcha.
Yeah. I would say it's 35. 35-65 like a fair percentage.
That's what we get for having that's what we get for saying something that one-sided and decisive, right? As soon as you say like, oh yeah, there's just like no chance.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna blow it out.
Can you guys please not sap me? I like casting this tournament. Don't sap the Crip.
I'm pretty sure if you avoid saying anything offensive and controversial, it'll be just fine.
Alright.
He's got a heal bot too, so this is like a lot of ways to be okay post Alexstrasza if it even lasts that long, but I don't think it will.
Funny thing is that he gets lethal this turn. Next turn, if he gets the owl from the top deck while playing True Silver now, he can owl something and then Blessing of Kings it.
Most likely not, though, because the Blizzard will kill the Zombie Chow and heal him up for 5 more health.
Oh, yeah.
So that unfortunately won't be the case on Trump's end, but Forsen does have a lot of stall, and he does have Alexstrasza. So if he can deal with this board, because 2 Blizzards will kill everything, I mean, there's still that chance.
What do you think of playing Kings on Zombie Chow? Is that a weird play?
You mean this turn?
Yeah.
That's pretty good, actually. That's actually really good.
Yeah, because the True Silver is going to be doing... You're not going to be killing him next turn anyway, so you still need 2 turns to hit with True Silver Champion, so you do protect him.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good point. Something maybe worth evaluating in the future if Trump ever goes back and analyzes the VOD for 4 hours on stream.
king. Well, I think here you definitely have to kings, and you, I don't think you need to save your true silver charge, because really the main thing you're afraid of is like a doomsayer or something. You have the BGH for a possible Alistraza, you have the equality consecrate against a doomsayer. So I think here you just want a kings, your quartermaster, so it survives Flamestrike or another blizzard.
Yeah, I like kings there too.
And I definitely want it on the quartermaster, because if the mage does Flamestrike, you don't want it to die next turn to a ping.
Yeah, I'm not sure why Trump keeps the Blessing of King for. That might be like a small tilting play.
Yeah, it could be the idea that he wants to surprise his opponent with it.
I wouldn't like to be in Trump's spot right now. I was there last week, but with Agro Paladin.
Yeah.
It's a really bad spot to lose for the team. Yeah.
Well, I mean, Forsen's in a similar spot too.
Yeah, but Forsen is in the winning spot with Freeze Mage.
Yeah, like Crip said, Paladin has single digit percent chance to win this game.
It is actually looking extremely bad for the Paladin.
That's right.
Yeah.
I never doubted you for a second.
Oh, it looks like my chart wasn't upside down after all.
Okay. No. You know, it was upside down after you flipped it around the first time, Doctor.
Right.
But I guess you get what you pay for when it comes to predictions like that. Doomsayer to try to stall for time.
Hmm.
Because he wants to go for the Alistraza plays next turn and go for the kill, I believe.
I think this is a good opportunity for Equality Consecrate.
Why not just push for lethal and hope he doesn't have Alex? I
wonder. Doesn't that do that?
I think you're one off, right?
There's Ice Barrier though, so it's actually not one.
Then you should probably test with one of the other minions first and buff the Aldor just in case it's Ice Barrier to kill the Doomsayer.
What about actually Equality Kings, like a compromise play?
Equality Kings. Yeah, that looks nice.
Equality, so the Peacekeeper kills the Doomsayer, and you can push for 12 damage.
How do you answer Alistraza, though? It's like, it feels like a pretty obvious Alistraza setup. So you can't actually kill it next turn. Well, I guess you can if you just trade a minion. Big Game Hunter finally fights fair against big minions.
Can Equality cons next turn?
Big Game Hunter becomes the big game.
Wow. Right.
What do you think of mastering there over hero power to get like a potential lethal with Quartermaster? But I don't think he can Alistraza. Like, first thing, he cannot Alistraza this turn. There's no way he can.
Mm-hmm.
He's like dead.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Also, like, Master would have set up Lethal, just in case of Alistraza. But Master is bad versus another Aerial of Effect spell, which you already seen two Blizzards. And if Force and Flame strikes this board, he loses. So I like Master more than Hero Power.
Okay.
What to do? He really wants to play Emperor Thorsen. In order to follow it up, he most likely will have to stall on the board, like Frostbolting the Big Game Hunter, but by playing Fireball, he foregoes his chance of playing the Emperor.
All he's doing is slowing the game down more and more every single turn, bit by bit. And I mean, you can't blame him. Forsen was in like an unbelievably bad spot at the start, still stabilized, slowed down the game enough to where we're at this stage. You can't really, like, especially after seeing the last game. You can't really believe there are many threats left from the Paladin at this stage.
He drew one of those threats.
Yeah, he did.
Tyrion Ford Ring. I mean, that's really hard to stop, because if the Ashbringer ever comes out, it's just you can't freeze the face every single turn.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like trading there? I really don't like trading, because there's a chance your opponent just draws into the last secret and then you deny the scientist. And he also needs free damage.
Protect the Divine Shield, though. So yeah. If Alistraza comes down, he can use Tyrion to trade easily and not have to give up the equality or something.
I'm not sure. Yeah, maybe. If you waited it up.
Well, Forsen's thinking of drawing a bunch of cards and then maybe setting up for an Emperor turn and then maybe setting up for an Anastraza. But is that a little bit too slow?
It's kind of slow, but that's what you have to do.
Yeah.
He still has double ice block.
Alright. 6, 10, 12, 13.
Now, should Trump over draw Forsen? Because they get close to the big.
You were saying that you don't think it's that big of a deal. He's got 10 cards left in the deck. It's not really that much fatigue.
You can only mill one. Just one.
Just one, okay.
It's not worth it.
Yeah, it's probably not worth it. Then all face, no space.
Yeah. We can run with that. All face, no space.
What's the no space for?
No room for anything else, man. Yeah. Just all face.
Oh, no. I thought it was supposed to be callback to how people used to say Kappa. Or something. Great face, no space. Well, I guess we just push for damage here. Consecration doesn't get much better, so there's like not a lot of minions that Freeze Mage tends to play. Tyrion already gets one hit in. I mean, Paladin can still do this, right?
He really needs a Nova there. He did not get it. You just have to protect your block here while you Emperor.
Yeah, and the heal bot here is so clutch.
Just I still think Forsen wins. Unless Trump runs Kazan.
Are you sure? Would be a bummer. It kind of seems that way, but I'm not sure.
How much damage does he have follow up right now? He's got 12, 7, or he's got 12 from the two Frostbolts and the Fireball plus the 4, so 16 damage.
20.
20 damage? Oh, because of Thanos.
Yeah. But he doesn't have mana to play it all in one turn, I think.
Well, he's got Emperor.
Yeah, you're probably Iceless that. So now Trump is gonna heal Forsen, he's gonna do half of the damage, I think. And then he's gonna draw into Pyroblast at some point and win. At the same time, if Trump draws into Lay on Hands, he can get himself out of the range.
How do you deal with Alexstrasza? Do you ignore her or do you acknowledge it? Because how much do you really care if Tyrion dies?
Yeah, Tyrion has another good weapon. Thing. Yeah, I think you completely just ignore Alexstrasza here.
I think you just play Boom and go for face because there's a chance that you win if he tries to flame strike you. As Creep said, you'll 100% win.
Yeah.
You think you play Boom here and just don't acknowledge the burn? Oh. Wow.
Oh, not knowledge to burn. Oh, I see, yeah.
Because he might 15. Just have 15 damage to kill you.
No, I think you're right. I think you have to heal. You want to play that boom, but you can't. You certainly leave the Alexstrasza up. I think you heal and muster. Just for some extra damage.
Boom was the aggressive play, but Healbot makes sense.
Oh, Frost Nova. Is that...
Yeah, that's what he needed.
That's like the key card, right?
Yeah.
So now he kills the Sludge Belcher, Frost Nova, plays the Emperor.
Mm-hmm.
And then he'll have 20 damage with the existing cards in his hand. But his opponent can't answer Thorsen, at least with just what he has, because he only has equality.
Well, I think he'll actually have more damage. Because...
Oh, because the minions on...
Yeah, you might be able to burn a fireball on Tyrion and gain damage with an Alexstrasza face hit in some situations.
Gotcha.
It's a bit tricky. Wow, that's a card.
Oh man, if Trump played Muster for Battle last turn,
broken the block.
He would have popped the block. Oh, that's really intense to handle. I think Trump realizes that, but. At least he can clear the minions here off the board. Again, I don't think you really truly care if Tyrion's like vulnerable to dying because you're not taking minion damage after this point. So you're going to be requiring that weapon. The Ashbringer will be threatening to pop the ice block every turn.
Yeah.
But there's still not enough damage in the actual hand of the Freeze Mage yet. He's got, what, 15 damage right now?
Yeah, it's not enough, but he's got a 2-mana ice block, and he can chain freeze the Ashbringer after he clears the board. So Forsen still has like quite a few turns left in this game, and that's a really big deal right now, because like its Paladin deck just has nothing.
Sort of, though, but what happens if it gets to the point... Okay. Well, what happens if it gets to the point where Dr. Boom's on the board and you need to, like, Flame Strike or something to stabilize? And the Boom Bot's there. Oh, never mind.
Okay,
so Lay on Hands is what Trump needs, right?
Is that the only out?
Because he can't even play a Heal Bot. He can't even play Heal Bot if he draws it.
He doesn't have space for Low Deb or Heal Bot, yes.
Oh. Nope. Uh-oh.
Yeah, that's gonna be it.
So yeah. Now, if he would have popped it last, like, 2 turns ago with the monster, would have he won? No.
No, because he could have, Forsen would have re-ice blocked and pyro the second turn rather than pyro the first turn.
Yeah.
Right, so yeah, what he would have done was go the opposite direction, just play the things that would have totaled to 10 mana instead. So Forsen finally grabs his first win.
Not yet.
Yeah, he could Frostbolt his own face. It's possible.
Yes.
We've seen that.
No, first. He makes it. All right.
So Forsen takes his first win, Freeze Mage, against the Paladin. Trump, that's his third loss here with the Paladin deck.
Single digits, boys. Single digits.
Single digits. All right, well, if now the Freeze Mage is out and we recognize that it is a bad matchup, and Oskaka queues up here like Rogue versus the Paladin, and then the series is tied, and then you have the momentum all the way on the Forsenboys side.
It's funny because Trump doesn't really want to queue Warrior because there's a chance that Forsen can queue Warlock and he can get the good matchup. He wants the Paladin into Warlock no matter what. But if Forsenboys thinks of how Trump thinks, they can just keep Warlock for last and go for Warlock into Paladin the last matchup and secure a 5-4 before that. And that's like pretty tilting for Trump.
That's right.
Yeah, there's not really much that that Trump can really do in these matchups. He's just at the mercy of how the cards fall.
The Midrange Paladin is like a really weird deck. Like the fast Paladin has so many more good matchups than the Midrange one. The Midrange one relies on beating the Warlock, on beating the Warrior maybe if you get lucky and they play a Control Warrior, on beating the Hunter, on beating their Paladin. Mm-hmm. Matchups which he lost.
I still think it's really interesting that they chose not to bring Warlock altogether because I think Warlock is just so powerful nowadays. There's multiple like top tier decks that Warlock can represent, which you still have the mulligan for completely different. In fact, there's Maligos that's also starting to get really popular, and then Handlock is still really strong and Zoo is still good. So it's like that's even more of a headache to deal with. And yet they've opted to not bring it altogether. So
and it is a complete guessing game too, with the format of the tournament allowing the teams to bring different decks every single week. Oh, look at that. That's a different deck.
Forsen changed.
Forsen swinging it up.
So he's not predictable in this matchup. Usually you don't really afford, you cannot really afford to keep Whirlwind versus Zoo, but versus Malilok is like an insta key because of Implosion. Mm-hmm. And Malilok relies on Implosion more than Zoo does. If you keep Whirlwind versus Zoo and you don't have a weapon versus Zoo, you're in a really bad spot. So let's see if Trump decides to keep the Whirlwind or not.
Well, he's also got Acolyte of Pain, too, so he recognizes their synergy there. But the weapon is really key. So he fishes really hard for it. And he gets a weapon, but he's going to be disappointed when his opponent's just been life-tapping for the first couple of turns here.
Yeah. Still, he's got that slam. He's got something. I don't know. I think the real problem in this matchup for the Grim Patron Warrior is just to have nothing at the start and what results in is you taking a lot of damage early on and having to use combo pieces to catch up.
Look at this. Forsen is going try hard mode. Oh, is he actually going to coin? I think he's just bluffing the coin to try to make Trump think like maybe he has like an awkward curve. And it's like Forsen using Trump tactics against Trump. I sense a little try hard from Forsen
bluff,
right now.
Bluff
I
coin.
I sense a little try hard.
What are you doing, Dad?
Used to be so carefree. Now, see, you know what it is? The bench awoken Forsen. His latent powers and his rage has built up, and now he's achieved the next level. No more games.
Okay. All right. Well, Trump seems a little puzzled here. Do you ever just want to, like, frothing? Whatever.
No, in this matchup you need to keep frothing to win, because if you manage to full cycle and get your burst, you just win this matchup so easily. The Modilock doesn't have that many taunts. It's a really good matchup for Green Patron, but the way Forsen drew this early game and the way Trump drew, I would say Forsen is favored to win this one.
Forsen is really favored to win, unless because you can't even really deal with two Azure Drakes or Twilight Drakes. I keep making this mistake. Followed up by big tempo plays of the Blackwing Corruptor. Those are just very problematic.
I actually like this play from Trump, because Forsen is forced to trade, and then he can use the War Axe to clear the Drake, and then he can just draw into the Execute. And after Forsen uses double Twilight Drake, he's not going to have another dragon to activate the Blackwing. So, this is going to be hard if he doesn't draw another Drake.
Yeah, it doesn't matter too much. Like, he still has a good 5 play, he still has a good 6 play.
What do you think of Darbomb tap? You know that your opponent is going to kill your Drake if you just trade. Do you want to donate him the free Twilight Drake and play another fresh one? Or do you want to get value from the Blackwing next turn? Like, I would see a Darkbomb tap just so you can play Blackwing the following turn.
Isn't Darkbomb, like, much more valuable than a regular Darkbomb when you know you're going to Tharson on 6?
Yeah, but I think I agree a lot with RDU says, because you want to get Blackwing Corruptor out as, like, a threat. You also saw that he didn't have Execute, so he can't deal with your second Drake. So if you can slam that onto the board effectively and know that he can't deal with it, you're going to be in a really good position. And the Dark Bomb is not really the key to victory here, because you're not trying to burst the... you're not going to out-combo the Patron Warrior. They get there as much quicker than you. You're going to need to use board control in order to win this game.
Okay, let's go with the Dark Bomb. Good call.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Forsen sees the play. And he also trades to play around the Trump having Battle Rage value. That's, again, really, really good from Forsen. He's definitely in tryhard mode.
Oh, that's right. He turned off the music.
The plug DJ.
You just have to take his hoodie off and then you'd be at this final form, right?
Put on like a shirt.
Oh, man. The Forsenboys jersey. Well, looks like Trump's just got a really slow hand, though. I mean, he's going to really need to get some good card draw soon.
Beltry is really good right now, because you saw the slam being played, so he needs a second slam to deal with the Belcher, and even if he deals with the Belcher, he has to deal with the slime, and the Emperor next thing is going to be huge.
Also, I don't know if Trump knows this is Maligo's handlock yet. It's still looking like it could be just regular handlock. All he's seen is 3 cards, a Dark Bomb, a Twilight Drake, and a Sludge Belcher, so... He might even mismanage his resource use in anticipation for Giants. Like, that could be what he's anticipating in the coming turns.
Mm-hmm. That's one of the reasons why Malilock was good in the first place and people started playing it. It's like a way better deck if you don't know, if your opponent doesn't know what he plays against. It's like the Echo Giants Mage deck. But it has seen a lot less play recently because people learned how to play against it.
I think it's seen quite a few play in recent tournaments, though, and the results have been pretty good. So I'm not too surprised to see Forsen bring out the deck. It's just, it feels like a deck that needs a little bit of practice. That's not exactly like Handlock. And I don't know, like, has Forsen actually played this deck in tournament setting before?
I don't remember him playing it, and I don't think he even played it on stream, so that's like a big surprise from Forsen. And it's a good surprise, because as we saw, Brian Kibler knew Forsen is going to play Freeze Mage. And this should tell people that Forsen is not that predictable as they think he is.
Mm-hmm. Man, this is such a good Hellfire.
Yeah,
is there an alternative though? Do you like have to Hellfire? Sometimes you feel like you can remove it.
So many possibilities.
Yeah, because he can't like Blackwing Corruptor and then Dark Bomb to control the board. If he could do that and then leave like a 5/1 patron, it would have been okay.
It's next mana crystal.
Yeah.
You can't afford to leave him any patron with more than one health because you have Belcher and he can potentially farm your Belcher for more patrons. Mm-hmm. So yeah, Hellfire is like a forced play here. And Thrum still doesn't know if Forsen is playing Handlock or Malilock.
Yeah, that's really annoying. And the worst part is that Trump also invested onto the board and he was hoping that maybe patrons can stick and he can get Battle Rage off, but this Battle Rage is just sitting here. Really is nothing. Just a one card draw at the moment.
It would have been a good Battle Rage if Forsen would have went face instead of trading the Armorsmith. He would have run two cards.
Yeah.
So one small trade making the difference between Trump having a really bad hand or him having an insane hand.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely agree.
Well, right now it looks extremely one-sided. And again, Emperor Tarson does see a lot of play in Handlock, so still.
Yeah.
But at this stage, it doesn't even matter. Like, if you're Trump, you're losing versus both variations.
This is right. The reason why some people decided to cut the second Fiery War Axe. I think Sixo is the first one that started it, and then a lot of professional players did the same thing. They cut Fiery War Axe and Red Corsair for more card draw to not lose in these kind of situations. You overall get, like, more percentages.
Yeah, the... sorry about that. Dropped my bag of Doritos. I think the second Fiery War Axe was really clunky against a lot of those mid-range decks too. And the cycle was super important, like you said. People actually experiment with different kinds of patrons, right? Like a tempo patron and then the cycle patron. And the tempo patron eventually won over the metagame because it climbed ladder really effectively. But the cycle one was still really powerful too. And I think nowadays you really want to get that cycle out because people are playing so well against the tempo versions. They know how to stop you every single time.
I know that Zalei is currently number one NA with cutting the second Fiery War Axe and Red Corsair for double shield block, which is like a really smart move.
Yeah, we actually saw him play that in the HTC tournament.
Yeah, it's a really interesting deck. You run shield block without shield slam, but you gain enough cycle to not be
dead in this kind of spots.
It's probably lethal if you don't get unlucky.
Oh. 18, 19.
Five, 14 plus 6. No.
Yeah, it's not enough.
Well, who needs that?
Ooh. Creative plays. By the way, Acidic Swampoos, shout out to the weapon removals. I definitely can get behind that for sure.
There it goes.
Man, that is a really cheap hand. He could play almost that entire hand next turn.
Yeah, he could do double block and corruptor, dark bomb, and double soulfire with spell damage.
Yeah. Look at that. The series is tied up, and Captain Forsen to the rescue evens up the series.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Mayor Trump is floundering a little bit. He's 0-4 today.
Well, Forsen's record is close to that in losses, right? I think Forsen's lost like 2 or 3.
I think 3. He's 2-2 today. He lost 2 games and then got benched. Then he thought long and hard about some of his mistakes, came back, tryharding, and then won 2 in a row. That's what happens.
Yeah, he got like assassinated by Kibler and then came back and took it all up against Trump.
It's true.
Okay. It's true. Well, Trump has still yet to win a game. He still has to beat Oskaka's Rogue and Chalky's Hunter. We haven't seen much from Chalky yet, but he was able to take his Paladin, take a win on his Paladin against Trump's Paladin in one of the earlier matches.
Yeah, I don't see Trump in such a good spot.
That Paladin deck, man.
Well, at least the Paladin deck can't lose 6 games. It only can lose 5 games maximum.
Yeah.
There's a silver lining to that cloud.
I think at this stage, because there's a real risk of your team losing, you kind of want some points on the board too. So I think that may actually lock in Trump to play Warrior. Plus, Warrior seems like it's pretty decent against both the remaining decks.
Yeah, this is where I think having good teammates is really important, so that they can, you know, ground you a little bit. If it's like Trump's losing and then he just keeps queuing up, and you know, Kibler went to go have nice mimosas at lunchtime with his dog, Shiro, and then dog went back to medical school like a, you know, like a proper young adult, then it's like, well, you know, Trump's kind of out there on the lone in his own desert island. But I have to imagine that Kibler and dog are also helping give some Trump some coaching tips in the corner, you know, let him, you know, putting on some of that water on his head, just trying to let him cool down a little bit.
Yeah. In the Archon team league here, these are the two kind of makeshift teams. So you might expect that there is some, you know, less than perfect team dynamic with, you know, how decisions are made and maybe with how, you know, losses are reacted upon. So you can't be like too optimistic in this case, but I hope things are going okay on that end.
Yeah, I have to imagine it will be. I mean, we've all had our bad streaks in Hearthstone, but it can continue. If Trump can't take down Chalky's Hunter here, then Forsenboys, despite being down early, will be on match point.
How about that? Mm. It's going to be Trump on Warrior, Chalky on Hunter. Again, most of these matchups are okay. They're like pretty close to 50-50 or favorite, I think, for a Grim Patron Warrior, regardless of what Hunter this really is.
I know that mid-range Hunter has been giving Patrons some fits. I'm curious to see what you have to say, RDU, because I know players flip-flop depends on what they favor in types of their decks. Do you like a mid-range against Hunter against Patron Warrior at all? Or do you think it's even or the other way?
I think mid-range Hunter is slightly favored versus Patron. On the other hand, Face Hunter is really bad versus Patron because Patron just needs one or two Whirlwind effects and one Armor Smith or Shield Block and they just win. But mid-range Hunter can just curve out perfectly into Savannah, and mm-hmm. Patron has a really hard time dealing with Savannah high main. I played both mid-range Hunter and Patron a lot, and I can say if the Hunter gets Savannah, an empty board is pretty much game over.
Okay.
That's not Chalky style, though. He's got that Worgen Infiltrator. Wait, Snake Trap?
It's a pretty cool idea, because you attack with Worgen and they have to deal with it, and if they deal with it, bam, snakes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Hearthstone's almost always better that you have 3/1/1s than a 3/3 creature. Just usually against Warrior, that's the exception.
So now, like, Trump doesn't know what secret to play against. He expects explosive from the Face Hunter, but he should also think of the Snake Trap possibility.
Yeah, I don't think it changes too much of his game plan. If he finds out it's Snake Trap ever, he's still in a really good spot because he has the Death Spy like soon.
If he predicts Snake Trap, if he predicts it, he can trade and then whirlwind the whole board. That'll be insane. Let's see if the Mayor of Valetown sees this play.
I don't know if you'll predict it versus I think it's just common to try and trade for a 2/1 if you have a 1/3 on the board. Most likely try to take out the Ironbeak Owl to avoid Beast synergy. And then it just happens to be that it's Snake Trap and he's just going to Whirlwind from that point.
I think he's just going to Whirlwind and he's going to attack with the Ghoul, realize it's like nothing, and then maybe even coin the Argent Commander. Like, you don't need to combo in this game to win.
Argent. Oh, you mean the...
Warsong Commander, sorry.
The Warsong Commander?
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Playing a Temple Warsong... Commander. Yeah, playing Temple Warsong is pretty nice in this matchup. It forces your opponent to use 3 damage to deal with it, or else they just lose. He values Battle Rage over Armor Up, which I can see.
Yeah, I like this sequence a lot. This is very nice for him to keep up the card count. Hunter's already struggling for damage now.
Wow. Like the Grim Patron Warrior outside of Armorsmith doesn't really have any life gain at all.
Well, it's got the hero power. The hero power helps. Like, you know, and that's still, you know, every little bit helps in this case.
Or if you play Shield Block.
That is true.
I don't think it's here in this one, though.
Yeah.
No, it's not in Trump's deck. Jackie can still, like, empty his hand next turn if he gets a 1 or 2 mana card and draw the card with Quick Shot, apply pressure. That would be pretty good on curve. What if he top decks Savannah? That would be nice.
Oh, yeah, we don't actually know truly what type of hunter it is. Because I don't think face hunters even commonly play Lotheb, right?
Yeah, some of them do.
Some do. I know that a few people were really experimenting with it. Like back when in Gfinity, I know Reyna was actually trying to test it out as a way to kill Freeze Mage as face hunter. Because people considered Freeze Mage to be a bad matchup for face hunter, generally speaking. And so that was like a case he replaced Leeroy with it. But now it could be more of that hybrid-ish approach because he's got weird stuff like Snake Trap as well.
I think you go for the hero power and keep the Quick Shot for the next turn.
Yeah,
you want to maximize damage.
I don't even know if it's worth it to Mad Scientist because there's a good chance it'll just stay alive. And I think if you're playing Worgen, you're probably playing Chargers, so... I think the Abusive Sergeant is probably getting more value not being played. I'll show them all.
Six mana, seven mana available to Trump with the coin. Not really looking at an opportunity to lethal in the next two turns, right? I mean, he does have two Whirlwind effects and a Frothing Berserker plus Warsong.
Mad Scientist complicates things a lot. It's so hard to play around all these things. I don't see Trump in a good spot. He needs to draw into Armorsmith soon. And if he gets Armorsmith, he can use the Warsong Commander with maybe Frothing Berserker and some Whirlwinds to clear the board and at the same time get some armor for himself.
What about Warsong Coin Gnomish Inventor to kill the Mad Scientist?
That means he will not be able to hero power. It's one of the good plays, probably maybe better than playing Frotting, because you get closer to the Armorsmith. But this play is more aggressive.
Yeah, this is a play to try to kill your opponent. And he's really hoping that this is like maybe explosive trap so he can get that bounce back!
Correct.
Oh, Trump is so surprised, the freezing trap out of nowhere.
Oh.
At least it's not misdirection. That would be even worse.
Oh, yes. You are absolutely correct, RDU. I mean, it could have been easily the misdirection. He would have lost the game.
It's still a pretty bad spot to be in for Trump.
Oh, yeah. My goodness.
If he would have expected that, Creep's play was better because you set up for proccing the freezing trap with Gnomish. Now Chuck is going to draw and push 7 damage.
Yep, doesn't even care.
But now not playing Abusive last turn, he misses 2 damage.
Okay, you gotta kill the Charger anyway.
Abusive would have died in the Whirlwind, right?
Yeah, but you still get the 2 damage out. Actually now, if he survives, he gets 3 damage. If he survives. So he had to wait the chance of Abusive surviving with the instantly 2 damage. That's what Hearthstone is about at this level of play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We don't mess around. This is Hearthstone. Acolyte. Such a defensive play here. Slamming on it. Or whirlwinding. I don't even know.
I feel like I might like the Frothing play a little better. Just Frothing Whirlwind Armor.
Yeah, you want to push damage at the same time armor up.
Whoa! Is that lethal? Potentially.
Let's see, he's got 9. If this juggle lands,
it hits,
is 9.
50-50!
We all love 50-50.
This is Hearthstone! No, it's
not
Hearthstone.
Never lucky.
Yeah. We're not Hearthstone yet, but that was very close.
Alright, well, can Trump actually win here with a ridiculous Frothing? It's going to have to be a cheaper one, because that 5 mana one is no way going to cut it.
I feel like if he draws Armorsmith, he still can stabilize, right? He's got 2 executes and song stuff, so he can Feels okay. Like he can.
Mm-hmm. It's a small chance because Chucky drawing bow, Chucky drawing any charger instantly wins.
Yeah, that's true.
And that's like after he lost the 50-50.
Oh, whoa,
that's
whoa.
A sick draw. He can charge, play the ghoul and the armorsmith.
He should charge the armorsmith too, right?
Yeah. Armorsmith can also take some damage. Although the priority is to keep Armorsmith alive, right?
What happened?
I think.
Oh, wait. He's not playing. He's going to use his executes instead? Okay. He's going to play executes and then play the unstable ghoul so that way the knife juggler or whatever crashes in has to give him more armor. That opens him up to.
Yeah, wow. A spell.
Oh my god. That's crazy. The second Armorsmith.
How is he killing that, though?
But just playing a stable ghoul and armoring up is really bad against Owl. He insta loses to Owl too. Did he forget to armor up? Oh no, never mind. So, Owl is insta win.
That's insta win.
Yeah, that's insta win.
Was the other play enough armor? I feel like it may have been. Charging, playing the war song, the ghoul, and the one armorsmith. Oh, that would have been a hover for sure. Never mind.
Chucky sends his love. From Indiana to California. Trump has lost 5 in a row.
That's a really bad spot to be. Especially for the next weeks. He's going to be tilting for the next weeks because he knows that even if his teammates win, he still has to get the wins.
Well, it's not over, RDU. I mean, Trump can still take home the victory, but now this is where you start getting a little nervous because, you know, they were up a pretty good lead, you know, 4-2 and then feeling pretty good.
Was it 4-2? Or was it before? Was it more than that? I think it was.
It was 4-1.
It was definitely at least one win. It wasn't like 4-0.
Right.
Chucky got the win fast. It was 1-1. It was 1-0, and then 1-1, and then 4-1, and now it's 4-5.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. That's right.
I would say that the Warrior is slightly favored versus Rogue if you play it perfectly. And I think Trump will play it perfectly. And the Paladin is like really bad. Like Paladin versus Rogue is like worse than Paladin versus Freeze Mage. So it's like less than one digit.
No, I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I mean, I play a lot of joke Paladin decks. So I have some experience with this.
Crip, you are literally every Reddit comment out there right now. Yeah, I've dipped casually into rank 17. Let me tell you, Paladin is great. It's like, all right, man.
No, I feel like... I think it's a bad matchup, but I think it's better than against Freeze Mage.
I can definitely identify with that.
Against Rogue, you just, like... They just don't have enough damage if you keep healing and keep laying down taunts.
Well, I think it's the tempo that you can often get, and Rogue, it's like, you need the specific removal... Like Rogue without coin against Paladin that has coin and curves well is like really problematic because then you don't get the benefit off of really subtle things like SI7 agents and being able to combo well and get like bio teacher stuff. So
They can still have Fan of Knives on your master and insta win. Well, not really insta win, but
well, like get like a huge advantage. Yeah.
One of the ways Paladin wins versus Rogue is like, again, as usual, Rogue just doesn't get sprinted at the right time and they run out of cards and then Paladin just outvalues them with True Silver on the free freeze, like Farseer and SI, and then just removing their whole boards with Equality Consecrations. I would see Paladin being in a good spot if he manages to be in a good spot after getting double sapped on his taunters. But first of all, we have another matchup. We have Warrior versus Rogue. In which you hard mulligan for weapons, you try to cycle, clear their board, apply pressure while clearing their board, and then set up for a frotting lethal. I think that this matchup is like highly favored for Patreon if both players played correctly.
I like the hand Oskaka has. It's just like very varied. He can deal with some of that early game garbage. He has some draw, he has a weapon. I think Trump's hand is really kind of all over the place right now.
You full mulligan that, but there is one interesting thing. Oskaka runs Harrison Jones, which is like really good versus Warrior if you get it on curve.
Yeah, that's true. Don't forget about Harrison Jones being a potential factor. Oskaka also plays Van Cleef, and I've seen him being rotated out in a lot of people's Oil Rogue decks. Maybe it's just for the ladder thing, but I actually like Van Cleef still in the decks. It helps you really race if you need to, especially against super aggressive decks. Like, you know, I've seen people use it against Hunter very effectively. So, what do you think about Van Cleef in a Rogue deck, RDU?
I think it's really situational. Like, if everybody's playing Hunter, of course you play Van Cleef. Even though he's bad versus Howl, it can help you race. But in a meta with Warriors, he gets executed, and that's not really what you want. In the Van Cleef spot, you can usually play Healbot or the second Teacher or another big threat. At the same time, you can play Deckhand for more damage. So it's like, according on how you want to build your Rogue, you can build it in many ways.
All right. Is there a play here that doesn't involve Backstab and a Hero Power?
Sap? I don't think you sap that.
No.
It's okay, you have two Backstabs. It's a card for a card, and you're left with a weapon. There's worse things out there. And you need to deal with that with Stable Ghoul early on because of things like what you said, the Acolyte behind it and making it complicated to deal with and drawing too many cards.
Inner Rage is really good here. It's really hard for Rogue to deal 2 damage in one go.
I actually think this might get sapped. I think... Oh, can you sap? No, you can't. I was thinking you could sap coin out the Van Cleef.
No, unfortunately you can't. You can coin out your Hero Power though if you feel frisky, but I think you better save that for the Azure Drake.
Mm-hmm.
And that works out great. Coin Azure Drake, backstab for 3 damage and kill off the Gnomish Inventor.
Yeah, pretty good curve. Here you can coin Drake. You can coin Drake and backstab and use the dagger to kill the Gnomish.
I mean, with 2 Drakes and the coin, it's just a clear play here.
Drake is really bad against
Deathbite.
Oh, well. What if you draw Harrison in the next 2 cards? That'll be nice.
Yeah.
Ostkaka is taking his time, thinking of all the options. Oh, he values the Sai.
Okay. So this is what it does.
It probably just values the coin more.
That means he's gonna go Drake into coin sprint, probably. He wants to be sure he gets that draw. He wants the Blade Flurry because Trump can just go YOLO at any time. So he needs the Blade Flurry.
Mm-hmm.
And he also wants to get rid of the useless sprint as soon as possible, because if you play it too late in the game, they can just kill you.
What now?
I like that. Being Ostkaka, you don't really have a play. You probably just donate him the Acolyte of Pain and Hero Power.
Let the pain speak to me.
Yep. That's what's going on. Warriors playing the draw game. Rogue's playing the draw game. Who draws the most powerful combo is probably going to win.
And he would have drawn Harrison.
The Harrison Jones.
Yeah.
Harrison is really good when you draw him, when you need him.
Well, assuming there's a weapon on the other side to even benefit off of.
Well, the thing is, I think the warrior kind of needs a weapon for his combo. So you just create that extra speed bump.
The problem with running Harrison in Rogue is that you make matchups like Druid or Warlock, which are really good. Like, you make them pretty bad. And I'm not sure if you want that, but in this format where you know your opponent is going to play weapon classes, it might be a good idea.
Is it really determined by that one card, Harrison Jones, as opposed to, like, I don't know if you're playing anything else like Sludge Belcher or Lothab, etc. Does it really make those matchups, like, unfavorable all of a sudden because you have Harrison?
Again, it's the way you want to approach it. You can play like Harrison or the second Healbot, as you can play like Van Cleef for the BGH in the free spot. It's how you want to build your Rogue deck for what meta you expect.
Well, Trump really struggling to come up with a turn here. He was kind of suggesting that he wants to play the Acolyte. I just don't see how that really works. Just Acolyte weapon, I guess.
You could trade into the Drake and then Acolyte Whirlwind, and if he wants to kill the Acolyte, he has to trade a free one, and you still draw 2 cards and remove the free one threat. And if he doesn't, you still have another Whirlwind for the following turn. But I think he wants to keep the Whirlwind to get a lot of damage with Frothing Berserker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or at least be able to draw off Battle Rage so that way he can get his Warsong Commander. Because the Frothing Berserker right now is just isolated, and it's a big threat, but it needs to be paired with the charging mechanism.
What do you think about coin oil into Van Cleef? Oh, that is actually happening. That's exactly happening. Okay.
That's the play because you put two big threats, so he needs to have double execute.
Oh, this is a great play.
Yeah, it's just a little bit weak on the weapon. You almost always want both charges when you oil.
I think the value that you get by having a big board and powerful minions on it is like okay, even if you have only one stack on your dagger.
Mm-hmm. We've actually seen some Grim Patron Warriors run BGH, but that's been phasing out slowly. You very rarely see that nowadays.
Yeah, same with the Rogue. People used to play BGH in Rogue and you don't really see that anymore. BGH lost value because people stopped playing that much Handlock. That's one of the reasons why Malilock is not being played that much as it was during DreamHack.
Mm-hmm. Alright, well, he picks up another way to be a little bit more defensive in the Dread Corsair, but definitely needs to stop taking the pressure here. Yeah, Trump's really milking these turns, trying to think as much as he can. It's a tough spot to be in because you're on the verge of getting losing six games for your team.
Yeah.
Ooh, seven to your own face.
Don't you think it was good to also try to draw from your Acolyte? Or you want him at the 2 HP spot to be immune to Fan of Knives?
I don't know. I think at this point, you're talking about using the inner rage, right, to cycle?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I feel like that's really important to keep for like Grim Patron or something if you need to, because I think the extra damage on the Acolyte or the extra draw here is not as important because he's not going to be able to deal the damage anyways. So I think it's fine.
That's a good sprint turn.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Look at that.
Trump needs the Death Bite faster. He didn't draw it. It's pretty unlucky. If he gets Death Bite now, he can get lethal next turn.
Armorsmith might stop some more damage.
The thing is that if you play Armorsmith or double Armorsmith, you're pretty weak against Blade Flurry. But you have to take that risk.
Isn't it that weak? And you gain 8 armor.
If you use Inner Rage, it's actually an okay spot to be in. You might also want to Battle Rage, maybe, because you need the weapon.
This bite is the key to unlocking. You already have a lot of small minions, and then the Dread Corsair becomes free, and you have 2 Whirlwind effects.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that can be easy, lethal.
But probably at this stage, you have to keep in mind, it's a team format. We are broadcasting on delay, but I'm sure the team is watching what's going on. They probably know the Harrison isn't Oskaka's deck at this point. So Trump probably knows with this many cards drawn from the Rogue that it is maybe even a liability to draw that much to hope for a weapon.
Double Blade Flurry is pretty nice. Oskaka is almost having lethal here. If he gets buff for the weapon next turn, he can get a lethal with preparation if he plays Flurries now.
Yeah, that's a good point. I like that.
He's a really tough spot for Trump.
Rogue has just so many cards. Also, like, sometimes Rogue just doesn't have anything. That sprint was really big, like you mentioned. Alright. He's got the Grim Patron. So what can you do this turn? I guess maybe he's also slightly regretting not being able to draw more with that second Battle Rage just sitting there.
You could Armorsmith, Whirlwind, Execute, Battle Rage, Armor Up, I know.
Oh man, but then you give away your Whirlwind effect and then you don't have a weapon, so like the Death Bite, so you can't guarantee that even if you draw the second Falling Berserker that you'd get insane damage totals onto it.
Then you can play Patron Whirlwind, get 2 Patrons out. And at the same play, draw some cards, maybe.
Yeah,
maybe your opponent doesn't have a way.
Yeah, seems like that's what he's doing.
Yep.
Trump needs something really good right now. This series shows how punishing the Conquest format really is. The Conquest format usually punishes weaker decks, but in a format where you have to pick 6 out of 9 classes, you're guaranteed to have some weaker decks.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, depending on the skill of the team on how they pick that weaker decks to manage to get wins on them.
Yeah, but the Patron Warrior is not exactly a weak deck at all.
People would say that one of the first picks.
Yeah,
that, but people would say that the Double Fire Warrior is kind of weaker. Most of the people just switch to one Fireworks to be more consistent.
Yeah, I agree. It's definitely the trend happening a lot.
Trump also lost most of his games on Paladin. I'm sure Warrior would have won most of these if he only played Warrior.
Well, if he loses this game, he actually lost 3 games with Paladin, lost 3 games with Warrior. So it's even. You can't really blame one or the other.
Isn't it 4 for the Paladin?
No, he lost... He lost 2 with the Warriors so far, and this is the 3rd that he's trying in a row, right?
Mm-hmm. All right, well, pretty good Harrison's going to come down, but again, we're at the stage where the Rogue is kind of running out of threats.
Yeah, but then he got Harrison to shut down the Death Spite. That's also really big.
Yeah, but in a stall game, the Rogue loses.
But, okay, you're right, generally speaking, if you give too much time to Patron Warrior, that is only the first Death Spite as well.
Yeah.
But Harrison's also a body on the board. And if Oskaka picks up any other semblance of board presence, like any of his 4 drops, which he has yet to pick up, like Pilot Shredder, it's just problematic for the Warrior to deal with. And he's not sitting at the most comfortable amount of life either. Like Trump is even defensive to the point where he puts the Dread Corsair down. Normally you save Dread Corsair for the moments you're going to go off with the Whirlwind effect, so you get either better Battle Rages or, you know, more damage on your Fathering Berserkers, etc., even more damage to the combo. But he's being defensive because he's worried about the Rogue being able to do too much damage to him here.
Emperor Tharson's pretty good, but I think any turn here involves Harrison first, just to see your draw and start to activate the combo effect.
Yeah. The Whirlwind effect, let's see.
You could think about sapping Armorsmith to deny him the armor. Maybe you top deck an SI and you finish perfectly on curve, killing the Dread Corsair.
What about sapping the Dread Corsair? So it costs 4 mana, probably.
That's also an option. But then you give him more pieces for the combo if he draws a second Death's Bite. Yeah, that's okay.
Wow, taking the Armorsmith very seriously.
He's prepping the Eviscerate, so he expects something from the top deck.
Yeah, hopefully a 3 drop.
He's just playing that, he's just playing that Thalnos if nothing happens to me.
Yep.
Okay.
That's the card Trump needed.
Yes. That's really helpful. And he can even hide that behind the Dread Corsair if he wants to protect it a little bit.
And it looks like he's going to do a Grim Patron turn.
Okay.
He feels threatened. Reasonable. He feels threatened, so he feels the need to go for the Grim Patron. But Emperor might be the winning play at this point. I think that if you go Emperor now and next time you go Warsong Patron, you trade into Thalnos, and then you trade a stable ghoul, you get 3 more players that can attack, you get the Whirlwind effect for the Frotting. You're probably close to lethal if you don't have lethal. But it's a risky play because you can die to oil combinations.
Yep. I mean, even just this Blade Flare clears the board, and now he's presented with the Pilot Shredder here.
Okay. Whoa!
That's a lot of damage. I think it would have been lethal.
Yeah.
Almost.
Yeah, because that's 12 damage over 2 turns. Yeah, I think that would have been crazy.
He has to play Flurry.
So really right.
Plays the Heal Ball just to be safe.
To be safe against 5 cards.
Oh, that's
you're
crazy.
Playing against Patron.
Yeah. Wow.
That's a pretty big draw too, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Although Thorsten doesn't really get that much value now. It's just more of like a 5/5 minion on the board that can present damage every single turn, because you're just reducing the cost, and it's like most likely you'll be able to play whatever comes out anyways next turn.
Trump can still win this game. It's not over.
Surely. Rogue is out of gas practically at this point.
Oh no, that's a pretty actually, that's a useless draw. It's completely useless.
Preparation? Only if he gets sprint
completely next useless.
Turn. If he gets sprint next turn, it actually might be very useful. But still an if.
I wonder how many cards are actually left in the Rogue's deck. I don't think there's that many.
That's a good draw.
That's a great draw. Now you can eliminate the Pilot Shredder and get it draw a card first. You want to slam after you play the Frothing Berserker so you get a little bit of damage.
Yeah. Even you waste and you want to play the Frothing after the Charger. So.
Yep.
You might get
some
lethal.
Some sequencing involved there.
Call back to last game.
Is there any way he gets lethal?
What if...
Not now, like before the draw. Like getting Frothing.
Yeah. Oh, what? Explosive sheep, maybe?
Oh, explosive sheep. Dang, I didn't even think about that.
I think Trump wins this game.
Yeah.
There's still a chance if there's Eviscerate being... Oh, no, he's one damage off, right?
He used both Eviscerates.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
He just wants to kill the Armorsmith.
He needs sprint. He needs multiple cards here.
That's not it.
No.
No, he's dead.
That's gonna
wow.
do it.
There it is.
Trump gets a
Trump
point.
Gets first win.
There you go. Now we are on match point. And this best of 11, both teams are on 5 points, waiting to get their sixth. Both Trump and Oskaka really trying to claim that second point that has been quite... Actually, Trump's first point has been very evasive.
I think the key turn was when Oskaka played a Healbot over playing Shredder at 23 HP. When we said that he was afraid, maybe playing Shredder, Trump would have been forced to still trade with it, and then he can play the oil on the Shredder and maybe even lethal him on spot. So that play might have mattered, actually.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually what we were talking about, too, when we were discussing plays. I really thought the Shredder was a stronger play onto the board, but you were saying that he was playing really afraid with 5 cards in the hand, and it happened to be that Frothing Berserker and... the war song, we're ready to go. I haven't seen Trump actually even draw Gromash. I wonder if he had that as a potential way to pressure too in the coming closes of the game. But there's been so many games we've seen the Warrior. I don't know if he has it.
Let's see how good the Paladin versus Rogue is.
Yeah, you guys were saying how it might be worse than against Freeze Mage. I certainly don't think so. Given my terrible attempts at Paladin against basically a net deck Rogue, which is probably a rough idea of this matchup. I think you'd probably lose 2 out of 3. I think that's my guess.
Okay, well, it's still pretty bad. We can agree on that. I don't think we have to necessarily compare it to like how awful it is, but it's still a really big struggle either way for Pal.
Quite a struggle.
You can win by pushing a lot of damage early on with like a perfect curve, with Master for Battle being unanswered by Fan of Knives. Or you can win by studding them down. But I still think Rogue is like 65-70% favorite versus Paladin. We'll see. Another way you win is like Rogue using saps on Shredders, and then you just play Tyrion and they don't have any answer for Tyrion.
Yeah.
There are many ways this matchup can go. We'll see. It's a really interesting series though. It's like 5-5, really exciting. Like nobody wants to lose it for the win. It's like such an important game. So much pressure going on.
Mm-hmm.
When I played my game at 5-5, it was probably like the first time in competitive play when I was actually afraid to lose. I was like sweating. It was like awful. It ended up good though.
Now, Oskaka was the one who was holding back the last few points in Forsenboys' first showing in the team league. You think maybe he has some added pressure from that? Maybe not feeling the confidence.
It's 1 week from there, but maybe. There is, of course, some pressure on Oskaka. I think he would have played the Paladin Shredder over Healbot if there was like no pressure on him.
Mm-hmm.
We see Trump counting some outs of Mulligan. And that's something really interesting because most of the people just do the Mulligan instantly whereas Trump likes to take his time to gain every single point of percentage in his win rate, which is really nice.
Yeah, Two Silver Champion, though, is really effective against Rogue, generally speaking. But I think the early game curve is also really valuable as well.
Oh my god. Double prep with nothing.
Wow. This is probably the most free hand you'll ever get in terms of cheapest spells or cheapest things in Rogue's deck.
Trump's hand is actually really good. You like Alders in this matchup a lot. I would actually even keep Alder.
Mm-hmm.
I would keep True Silver if I was on the coin, so I like Trump's decision of mulliganing True Silver away. True Silver is really good versus Azadrakes, of course, versus SIs, versus Farseers, but it's really bad versus Teachers. It's decent versus Shredders. Versus Shredders, you want Aldors, that's like the best one.
Have we seen a single Violet Teacher from this Rogue deck?
Not yet.
No, I don't believe so. Violet Teachers in general have been a liability. So, yeah, they're not as valued, and coincidentally enough, it makes them, a little bit worse against things like Paladin, which you can have the 1-1s matchup against Paladin. Even though they do get cleared eventually by things like Consecration, you can help fight back on the board a lot more effectively.
Do you like the Tempo Aldor there, guys?
Yeah.
The thing about the Tempo Aldor is that if your opponent doesn't have a threat, then you can continue to curve out pretty well. So I like it only in the context of that Oskaka doesn't have an immediate response on the board.
You could have played Knife Juggler. Like, the worst thing that can happen when you play Juggler is your opponent playing Backstab or SI. And if he plays Backstab plus a free drop, you have the Alder for his free drop. If he plays an SI combination, you have Alder for his SI. Whereas, if you play Alder on curve, you lose the Alder effect, but you gain the potential of going Juggler on curve with either Hero Power or the second Juggler. So again, now they have to like value to see if it's better to curve out perfectly or just play off curve but get more value on spot.
What do you think about Juggler and then the dude versus Juggler, Juggler?
Juggler, is Juggler it... sucks versus Backstab SI.
Yeah, but don't you think Backstab had like a decent chance of being played on the Alder last turn?
It probably had.
Yeah, like definitely really considering that he had the weapon charge up still.
It could also be like a bluff from Oskaga to force Trump into playing Knife Juggler. The thing is that if you have one Backstab and one SI, you usually want to keep the combo for when you play both, and it's not really worth it to Backstab SI and Aldor, so he probably just played Farseer to bait out some more stuff for Backstab SI. So maybe Trump thought of that and decided to go for an alternate route.
Alright, well, Trump's got his own Harrison, which is going to come in handy in this matchup. Getting a little bit better and better here. First, Oskaka having the terrible draws. Trump having some decent draws and getting the Harrison.
Back-to-back Harrison.
Yeah, but I feel like it's much more relevant if the Paladin has it. Like, you know, it's a bonus if the Rogue has it against the Paladin, but it's a bigger bonus if the Paladin has it against the Rogue, don't you think?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, if you can shut down the Blade Flurry, that's just so big. So, generally speaking, you're correct. Although I wouldn't underestimate the power of being able to take away a Paladin's True Silver Champion or drawing an insane amount of cards if you somehow get their Ashbringer or something.
Also, the way Rogues usually play with the Blade versus Paladin is they use the first stack to kill one monster and then the second one to Blade Flurry, unless there's like a big enough board to be worth to instant Blade Flurry. We see Trump not playing the Shredder in the middle. Let's see if he gets punished for that.
Yeah, no, that's the one thing that's about technical play.
Did we also see the Shredder played before attacking in? I missed that for just a second.
The Shredder was played before.
Huh? He played everything and then attacked in.
So he tried to go for the double juggle, the 1-4.
I think the best way to go for that is like you test the first juggler, and if it hits, you can go for the second one.
Mm-hmm.
That's like the way to abuse the RNG.
Yeah,
I like sap on the Shredder because you have a second sap for some bigger threats. But again, we go into this spot where if he uses double sap too early, he might just have no answer for Tyrion. Tyrion being at 6 HP is a really rough spot for the Rogue. It's so hard for Rogues to deal with Tyrion. The Divine Shield plus 6 HP is just destroying them. But, well, of course they have Sap. So one Sap has to be for Tyrion usually.
Mm-hmm. Alright, well, the Juggler goes down to the SI. Trump's still in good shape right now. And there isn't that much in hand of Oskaka even after the sprint.
We still got Ash, Drake, and Harrison for draws, and Thanos, so he's still got ways to refill the hand.
Yeah, but he doesn't have like any real substance right now. He's just like still playing the whatever cards I got, they go down type of game. And I mean, that's the game the Paladin plays all throughout, but usually the Rogue has more to benefit from card synergy and combos.
Yeah, fair enough. Slush Belcher is normally pretty annoying to deal with, but in this case, it's also Eviscerate managed to clear it off.
Looks like a pretty clean Azure Drake Eviscerate.
Do you also backstab? So, you kill the one to slime?
Maybe with a spell damage in hand. As well as maybe the Azure Drake surviving, keeping the backstab has a decent amount of value.
Sap?
Let's go with Sap. Okay.
I really don't like using Sap here.
If he drops Tyrion right afterwards, does he have a way to respond to it?
Playing Sap versus...
Oh, no. I think he doesn't... He maybe want his opponent to play Tyrion, because if he can deal with it, like with the 6 mana or the 6 damage Eviscerate on the Blood Mage Thanos and Azure Drake, he can Harrison too, right?
Oh, that's really smart, actually.
Yeah, so like he backstabs Eviscerate Tyrion, and then Harrison's the Ashbringer.
I don't think he has mana to do all that.
No, because he has to play the...
Thalnos.
Yeah, he has to play the Thalnos, then do the Eviscerate play, then Harrison. So okay, he's one mana off, and one mana with like a Tyrion on the board, and you not be able to answer it might just be like a bit too much.
Okay. Maybe I'm just reading too much into things then.
No, but that is
the last
idea,
girl
I believe.
Told the Crip. Is that what you're telling me?
No, it seems. It seems like a good idea to use Sap when it's favorable if you have an answer for Tyrion, and he does. So I think in general it's good. It's certainly interesting.
Trump doesn't really like playing Shredder in the middle.
I was about to say, man. Ever since you started pointing it out, RDU, I can't not see it anymore. So it's like, ugh. Because it's like, I started... Because people did it so often nowadays that I've forgotten to really... Oh, look at that! Look at that! It doesn't really truly matter because it's cleared, but...
Yeah. Once you miss little ones, which happened to me, you'll always play it in the middle.
Oh, you miss lethal by not having it in the center?
Yeah, I got flame tongue. Not in the tournament, just on ladder.
Yeah. Mech Shaman, I take it.
Oskaka just refuses to keep the dagger, which is like playing around Harrison, a card you know Paladin is having, and he may look at how many cards Trump was keeping, and he saw that some cards were kept for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Trump also knows that Oskaka doesn't have any more saps, so he can play the towns without caring.
That's quite a bit of damage, but Trump still has a lot of life left. And the thing is, like, with the Rogue here, if you can't push for, like, a really dangerous situation, I don't know if you could actually just dump these cards for face damage, because you have nothing left afterwards.
I think if it's like almost you have to go for it though, because your hand is really aggressive. This is 6, 10. If it lands on the Drake, that's massive damage. Actually, it doesn't really matter. It's massive damage either way. You can manipulate it so that the South Sea Deckhand guarantees takes it out.
There's not going to be a South Sea Deckhand this turn, is there?
Oh, he's even going one step further. He's trying to bait out Harrison before it, right? Oh man, he really wants Harrison to come down from Trump. I really like the way Oskaka's playing this match.
Yeah, he's waiting out all the stuff from Trump.
Did we see the Harrison and Trump stack up until this game, though?
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah.
And like 90-something percent of the paladin run Harrison, because you can afford to.
Yeah.
Harrison here, though, it actually draws you one card, and with that one card, you really want it to be like True Silver Champion. Trump decides to go instead for Lay on Hands.
Oh, I like Equality here.
I don't think you use it now. You might want to be greedy, right?
No. I think it's good enough to use now.
Trump wants to be greedy.
You can be a little bit greedy and still set up a reasonable board afterwards with Muster, right?
Oh, wow. Okay, that's a bit of damage.
8, 11 exists on board, plus 2.
It's 13 in
6.
Hand.
6. Okay, 13 in hand lethal, plus 11 on board, so that's not lethal.
Yeah. And the thing is that if Trump manages to stabilize, and I would definitely see him doing that, Osaka is in a really bad spot unless he draws Sprint.
If he plays Muster for battle, he might just Harrison that and draw more cards.
Yeah.
What if he just goes for, like, Equality Consecration into Hero Power, and then next turn he draws Tyrion? He just wins because Osaka has no answer for that.
That'd be a pretty epic way for Trump to climb back. Like, he's down, losing 5 games in a row, and just wins the next 2.
He'll prove he's the true mayor of Value Town. Well, Osaka might go for a really greedy play.
I think he's just going to set up for a 2-turn lethal. Uh-oh.
This is going to get Harrison, right?
It is going to get Harrison, but I think the idea is that if you get Harrison, you can't get like your board messed with too hard.
Yeah, you can't Equality Consecrate you after Harrison.
Yeah. So I like it.
Oh, he doesn't even attack the weapon.
Can't.
He attacked already in the zombie chow.
Oh, yeah. Just kidding. False alarm.
You're just testing us, right?
You guys, and you guys passed. Congratulations.
All right. Yeah. Okay, well, I think this is Equality Consecrate and maybe Kings on the dude.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a way to clear everything. Usually you would go like Equality Trade Consecrate, but because you want to Kings the dude, you go Equality Consecrate Kings.
You just don't have a better 4-mana play.
And next time you can have like Harrison into Sludge. She's super good. And this way you don't play weapons into his Harrison, which you know he has. Trump is roping this out. Let's see if the animation helps him. Oh.
Wow, he's being really greedy here.
Yeah.
He's shutting down the weapon now so he can gain life there.
He has a kill bot. This is gonna cost him.
4, 8.
He forgot
he only
about
needs a little bit more damage.
Yeah, but he might get it. Here. The...
Oh!
Oh!
There you
That's
go.
It. That's it!
Wow.
And Forsenboys will take it. Oh my goodness. Is he gonna drop the Harrison as well?
That's
brutal.
No!
Oh man. Osaka realizing that
and
that was,
Blade Flurry.
Sense.
Poor Trump.
Yeah, Trump bites it here.
Well, only one of them could win and close it out for their team, but Forsenboys gets their second win. That was really close call, though. Trump almost was able to take it home, but unfortunately was not able to.
Well, with a few different plays, I think he would have won that game. But it's really close plays. It's really hard to judge which one is going to have the best result. It sucks to pick wrong and then know you would have won if you did anything else. That's all.
Oh, well. The Paladin ends up dropping 4 games here and ends up being the LVP. Right?
Trump didn't win.
Trump ends up dropping 4 games with the Paladin, right?
Yeah, but we're looking at...
the graphic.
Where Value Town won.
Yeah. I thought you
rigged. Riots.
That's right. We need to create more drama and controversy. No. The graphic might have just incorrectly displayed it, but Forsenboys end up taking the victory here. Well done. And that wraps up our first match of the day. We have two. We have Tempo Storm versus Archon coming up next. But before we go, we also want to thank RDU for stopping by on the cast. Do you have any last words you want to say about that series?
Thank you for having me here. It was a really insane series, really close. And it feels bad to play Conquest in this kind of way, because you don't really want to lose for your team. It's so painful. I feel for Trump now.
Yeah, no worries. Well, you can go ahead and send your Skype messages to him. Or you can hashtag ATLC on Twitter and let us know what you guys think about it and send your messages of condolences to Team Valuetown or congratulations to Forsenboys as they were able to weather the early storm and finish out strong, being able to take the series 6-5. What we're going to do is we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to have a new guest caster, Strifeco, hop on with me and Crip, as well as Archon vs. Tempo Storm. It should be a good one. I'm excited. Stay tuned, guys.